right now physically. I couldn't stay healthy. Rossi takes the pain fast.
There's a lot of companies out there that are doing food crap, and what I really like about what Trifecta was doing is it's good, clean product that is high quality, and I know that there's nothing extra added into it. Now I have more time to spend recovering or being in the gym or doing electricity work or honestly spending time with people that I don't wish to spend time with because of the gym so much. It is hands down the biggest help any athlete could have ever asked for.
Event three. are getting things started right now with the 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. We're going to go right into 100 double unders, followed by 50 wall ball shots and 10 rope climbs. Then they're going to go back down the ladder to 50 more wall ball shots, 100 more double unders, and to finish out, they're going to do 100-foot overhead lunge.
Ooh, that's a mouthful right there. This event does have a time cap of 16 minutes. They are working with an 80-pound dumbbell, and then they'll have a 30-pound wall ball. We've got our first double unders happening at the far end in the red t-shirt, black shorts. Latower, I believe that's Latower.
Josh Latower, our first athlete. Quinn Boyer, not far behind. Double unders here. Another walk in the park for these regional competitors.
Well, it should be anyway if you made it in here. Double unders, right? When you're jumping up, that rope is going underneath your feet twice. Nice little lung and shoulder burner right there.
And of course, we saw double unders in the open in 17.5. They comboed up some thrusters as well as the double unders, and right now these guys making way through the 100 reps here as we have just hit the 2-minute mark.
Josh Latower moving down the line. So we got the 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. He completed the 100 double unders, moving on to 50 wall ball shots with a 30-pound wall ball.
Latour, Boyer, Swami, and Trulio were our first four athletes to move forward to those wall balls. Wall ball's another movement we saw in the CrossFit Open. However, that was a 20-pound ball, and it was 55 reps per round. So we'll see how these athletes now handle the extra 10 pounds, Kiki.
Exactly, Dave Castro raising the stakes once you get into regionals. Bumping up the weights on the dumbbells and the wall ball as we hit 3 minutes in. The tower moving over to the second target. Letting us know he's more than halfway on those wall balls. Trujillo making that move as well.
So Kiki, talking to some of the guys who have practiced this workout, it really comes down to those 10 rope climbs as far as when this workout kind of starts taking that turn towards the nastier end. Because don't forget, after those 10 rope climbs, those guys got to make their way back down the list. So pretty smooth sailing so far right now. But I have a feeling going into the rope climbs, that's where we're gonna start to see our leader build even more on that lead. Josh Latower, our first athlete, finishing up the wall balls now as he makes his way now to the rope climbs.
That rope climb would be the new element. Although the wall ball is heavier, I'm sure these guys have worked into their training before. That rope has been cut short indeed. As you'll see, they'll run up and jump up on that rope, starting with legless, and then if they need to, they can hook their feet in. But as they work their way back down, they have to have their hands past that black marker before they can jump down. I was talking about it earlier, but I'm sure there were a lot of affiliates that chopped their ropes after the announcement was made for this particular event if they had a regional competitor. 5 minutes in.
Okay. And if you see, Kiki, these athletes are moving a little token up the rope rig. So every rep that they perform after the rope climb, you'll see them walk over and advance that token forward through the 10 reps.
Remaining. crash the tower with 25 reps in. Trujillo, about ready to hit that halfway marker on the wall balls. There it is.
Five minutes remaining, athletes.
Mental and physical fortitude being tested here at day two of the South Regional, brought to you by Arasti.
Josh down here in lane number three, trying to make some moves here on the wall balls. He just knocked out a big set. He's gonna take a quick break. Ramos still holding the lead right now. Now we're closing in on the 12 minute mark.
With about 20 seconds to go! must have like 15:59 on that scorecard.
30 seconds. Athletes on your green starting mat, please. Athletes to your green starting mats, please. Job. Barnett into his double unders.
Kung Fu did do his double unders as well, though those guys looked like they went unbroken. ...100 double unders before they head into the wall ball. Pretty simple workout, you explained it a second ago. They're gonna go through the workout and then back out doing the exact same thing in the opposite direction. Be a little bit more winded. 90 seconds in.
I'm telling you right now, those wall balls are no joke. We did see them in the CrossFit Open, so these guys have done them before, but probably not at 30 pounds. Now, of course, these guys are regional competitors, so I doubt we'll see any problem there, but for normal CrossFit people like myself, I'm more of a 20-pound wall ball guy myself.
Normal, you got jokes.
Down there in lane number three right now, some of our gentlemen already making their way to the wall balls. Richell as well. Connor McDonald here in the purple and pink making his way onto the 30-pound wall ball.
Wall balls followed by 10 rope climbs. And again, with the bottom third or so of that rope cut off, it's going to force these guys into legless rope climbs, at least for the initial portion of this. Again, you call them the regional athletes. That's probably not a problem for these fellows.
No, I don't see that being a problem, Larry, because right now, we're already getting a handful of individuals that are getting close to that halfway mark on the 50 wall balls. Once you see them shift over to the next placard, like Matt Mortan has. Right now, Matt, our heat leader down here in lane number 9, already on that far side.
Approaching 4 minutes on the clock. A number of these guys are all onto that second half, the downhill side of their first 50 wall balls.
And there we saw in the last heat, 50 wall balls, not a huge problem, but it starts to really take its toll about halfway through those 10 rope climbs. We started seeing some fatigue building up right around rope climb number 7 or so. And then it's just hold on for the ride the rest of the way home. So Matt Morton down here in lane number 9, judges hand in the air, there's his final wall ball, and he is going to be our first athlete now to make his way towards the rope climbs. Here he goes, right up that rope grid. Once again, must make contact with the placard up at the top. Then he's going to grab his little token and advance it there on that far side of the rig. Matt now being joined by Connor right next to him. Austin right next to him.
.15 on the clock. A couple of hands in the air on this side. Vargas and Savili. Just a couple of reps to go as well. Looks like Chris Reed in lane number 4 also done. And about to start his rope climb. So Philly with one rope climb to his credit.
Warren down here working on rope climb number 5. Connor McDonald, not far behind on number 3.
just past 6 minutes, and again, 16 minutes high cap on this event. Josh Lightower doing a fantastic job in heat number one, setting the time to beat. Trying to get that time for you guys, right in the 14 somewhere.
Remaining down here for Lord. Here in lane number nine, as we approach 7 minutes now, Connor McDonald finishing out another rope climb as well. So now McDonald and Morton are rep for rep here, as Connor starting to gain a little bit of ground here on the rope climbs. There it is, Connor now taking the slight lead here over Matt.
Seven and a half minutes elapsed. 10 rope climbs right in the middle of this event. The dividing line, so to speak, between the front half and the back half. I think Brent hit it right on the head, probably around rope climb number six or seven is where it's really gonna start to set in.
Final rope climb here for Connor McDonald now. You can find him with the purple t-shirt, pink headband, there it is. So Connor now our heat leader here in heat number two, as he is trying to chase down Lightower. One more rep remaining for Matt Morton. But now Connor is gonna start building on his lead here on the 50 wall balls. Big set right out of the gate here for Connor. As Matt gets ready to strap up and join him here on the wall balls. Chris Reed also joining him on the wall balls.
So Billy back to the wall balls, as is Vargas. Fifteen on the clock, 16-minute time cap again in place for this event.
So Connor now looking to be our first athlete. We're advancing into another set here. As we have just now hit that 10-minute mark, Larry, that means we got 6 minutes remaining.
Connor finishing the first half of this round of 50 wall balls. His last look at the wall balls, you see him shifting from one target to the other. Now comfortably in the lead for this heat. Again, several heats of competitors to go.
Second set, Morton as well. Also looks like Cefeli down there in lane number two. We're working on those final 25 reps here. We saw in the last heat, Larry, it came down to the double unders. And then the overhead lunge, I'm sure it's gonna happen the same here. We'll see if some of these gentlemen able to finish under the cap. They got just under 5 minutes.
Coming about 12, fresh coming about 11 minutes and 30 seconds. And Connor McDonald done with the wall balls. Kind of taking a little bit of a pause for the cause, getting his mind right for these double unders. McDonald out of Norbo CrossFit. Beaumont, Texas area. Trip back with the dumbbell, coming about 12 minutes. Looks like Barnett also done on the wall, so it's gonna be one McDonald, two Barnett, and the battle now at the rig for third place.
And a big set here out of the gate for Connor McDonald. Looking nice and calm here. As he chisels away at that second round of 100, he's gonna gather himself now with a quick break. Here comes Morton, as Barnett also continuing to work.
Looks like Morton's making his way out. That's gonna round out your 1, 2, and 3. McDonald, Barnett, and Morton. Andrew Savilli also done. He'll make his way out and grab his rope, putting himself in fourth currently. Coming up on 13 minutes.
We got 3 minutes remaining now. Looks like we got five gentlemen working on the double unders. Connor McDonald with that slight lead. But now Barnett with the judge's hand in the air. Barnett and McDonald, lane 6 and lane 8. It's gonna come down to the overhead lunge.
Here we go, this is the race we were talking about, B. Barnett stretching it out, lunge after lunge. Here comes Connor McDonald. They're your 1 and 2. A number of guys vying for that third place slot.
David Barnett doing some work. Center stage. He's gonna have to rest. But Connor McDonald, nipping at his heels. Well, ladies and gentlemen, let's make some noise for these fellas. They got about 2 minutes.
Barnett. With about a 10-foot lead. Barnett just a few lunges away from finishing this up, approaching the 14:30 mark, 90 seconds, fellas. A 16-minute time cap in place for this. Barnett catches a no rev, unable to hang on to it. Can McDonald capitalize right here, Britton?
It does open the door here for McDonald. Oh, so close. McDonald now has an opportunity. Dumbbell. Connor McDonald able to take it right there at the finish. Barnett with a great finish as well, right behind him. Gentlemen, we got 45 seconds.
And lunging his way towards the finish line in lane number 4. Looks like it's going to be Chris Reed rounding out our 1, 2, and 3. Reed with a time of 50:27. 30 seconds, fellas. Savilli just a few lunges away as well. Just 3 finishers so far in this heat with 15 seconds remaining. Savilli catching a no rep right at the end. 10 seconds. Make some noise, folks. Let's cheer him on. 3, 2, 1. And that is time. So Philly's time, 15:59.5, just under the wire. Big round of applause for all the athletes in this heat. And it looks like Light Tower's time will stand for heat number one. We'll be back at you with heat number three here in just a minute.
Teams are complete. We are already through a few heats of men individual competition in downtown San Antonio inside the Alamo Dome on day two of the CrossFit South Regional. I'm Jeff Brightwood alongside James Hobart. And yesterday, James, saw some of the favorites play out like we thought they would. Saw some people kind of fall down the leaderboard early, but one guy that made a move, Easy Muhammad.
He's had this quiet consistency as he's moved up. You know, hasn't made too much hype about his plans this year, but he is a competitor. He's been to the games before. I expect to see Easy with the wall balls and the rope climbs do pretty well in this workout and continue his climb into that fifth place spot.
One athlete that we saw bust onto the scene, Dakota Rager.
Guys like Dakota can be scary. You see he has the potential to win events. I've seen his Instagram. He trains with high volume. I think he's got the gas for this workout. I just want to see if he gets choked up on any of the movements.
And one athlete that we really wanted to watch, thought could do very, very well here in the South Regional because he has before, and that's Logan Collins.
You've seen Logan Collins be strong kind of everywhere. He has two third-place finishes. Consistency is what gets people back to the games. I don't think he's going to have an amazing performance in this event. I think we'll see something consistent, and he'll continue to stay in that top five spot.
Well, they're getting set for event number three, heats three, four, and five. Let's take a look at how the standings sit through the two events from Friday. And you see Logan Collins with 180 points, a 10-point lead over Travis Williams, followed by Rager. There he is at 169 points. He's only 11 points away from potentially winning. But as we talked about earlier today in teams, it's the top five that really matter.
Yeah, this top five, it's definitely not locked in yet. Logan Collins is doing a really nice job. Zachary Moran, Joseph Geisner, who has been to the games in 2016, just last year, are just banging down that door to push into that top five spot right past Easy Muhammad. This event is going to matter a lot for these guys. We have three events left after this one for the weekend.
And here is individual event number three. James, a little similar to yesterday, how we started off with a longer time domain. And went a little bit quicker in the later afternoons.
Start off with that 100-foot overhead walking lunge, 100 double unders, 50 wall ball shots with a 30-pound ball for men, 10 rope climbs, 50 wall ball shots, 100 double unders on the way back, and then one last foot race, 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge to bring it home.
So a lot going on here in a 16-minute time cap. Let's take a look at the lane assignments, how they will line up here in heat number three. And right now your highest ranking athlete here in is a lane five in heat three is Tater Domingo out of River Parish CrossFit in Luling, Louisiana. And that is how they will line up here. Again, this is the third of five heats. That is Lance Castle out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, a 30-year-old, a three-time regional vet, his highest finish, 2014, was 10th.
Here on our Happy Armed Forces Day to all our servicemen and women here as we see Lance Castle take off. He was the 15th fittest military man in the open, serves in the U.S. Air Force but also we have Scott Tetlow in this event as well. He'll be in lane 7, former U.S. Navy, as these guys take off for the overhead walking lunges.
All right, 16-minute time cap. We started off with a 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge. And James, you're well-known not only as a CrossFit athlete individually and team-wise, but also on the seminar staff, a flow master, so we have some time in this event. Let's talk a little bit about the methodology in CrossFit and why we would be doing a one-arm overhead walking lunge. It starts out core to extremity.
Absolutely, core to extremity, and the simple ability to stabilize something overhead with your midline, squeezing the abs, making sure the erectors in the back and keep that dumbbell over the frontal plane, the center line of the body, as these guys lunge down the floor. That's essential to every other movement that you guys are going to see in CrossFit.
Of course, the regular CrossFit community kind of knows that. For those outside the CrossFit community just getting into it, that is the reasoning, and that is what brings forth that capacity for fitness in this event. And you know, you always have those friends that are going to try CrossFit, they haven't done it, and they look at this and they go, what are you doing? You're just jumping rope. They don't know how taxing that is.
Absolutely. And what's interesting too is that these guys are the best of the best. The nice thing about this program, here we see the tip of the spear. It's infinitely scalable. My 57-year-old mother does CrossFit. It doesn't quite look like this. She'd like to think it does, but varies by degree, not by kind.
Grant Melrose in first place, followed by Matt Strand. And in third place right now is Taylor Domingo. And there's Connor McDonald right now has the time to beat 15:04.01. He did that in the prior heat number two.
That's a really solid time for this workout. You're not going to see these guys get too hung up on the first half, or I should say first third of this workout. Lunge, double under. Things will start to change. The meat of this is the wall ball, 30 pounds, and that rope climb in the middle.
50 wall balls will start on the target to the left through 25, and then move on the target to the right. Now, when they come back, they'll start out on the right and move back to the left.
I think a couple things you want to watch out for these guys. I don't imagine anyone's going to hit these all unbroken, but if they do let that ball rest on the ground, they only want to let it rest down there for a little bit of time. You kind of have to pay attention to that stuff, whether you count out your rest period in your head or you take a look at the clock. You'd be surprised how quick 10 seconds can go by.
Being in heat three, these athletes are really on the outside looking in, but if any of these athletes in heat three were to hit a couple of home runs today, there's 200 points available today in two events, could find themselves potentially in heat four tomorrow. You do well there, maybe you're in the last heat. So you can kind of let it all hang out here in heat number three. You're going to have to if you want to make a big push.
Maybe those top five guys right now in the region as we head into heat three stay in their beds and sleep in tomorrow. We could see these guys creep into there. But heck, you know what? I don't think there's any athlete out here who's going to just give up the fight just because they don't think it's mathematically possible to creep into that top five spot. These guys will fight to the bitter end. That's why they're here in the first place.
50 wall ball shots. Once you see these athletes start doing the wall balls to the right side, that means they are halfway through, as Jordy Gramillion on the far right in the Army green shorts, still on his first 25. So is Archer Machado and Augustin Garavaglia. Those are the three athletes you see in lanes 8, 9, and 10 from left to right.
And you see a couple of these guys jumping off the ground there. Arthur Machado jumping off the ground to get that ball all the way up. It's still a 10-foot target, but don't forget that thing is 30 pounds. It adds an extra punch even though it's just 10 pounds over that regular 20-pound wall ball that we're all used to using.
11:17:02, the event record by someone in the East named Matt Frazier.
Haven't heard of him, but that is lightning fast time.
That's 4 minutes under the time cap. Still, we have Melrose, Strand, and Domingo, your top three, and they're all on the wall balls. And there's the implement on the Rogue rig where you can kind of monitor on the rope climbs what rep they are on. The little place car, the magnet. I went down today to the judges meeting because I saw an athlete breathing and didn't know how it was moving up and down. Just a little magnet, take it off, move the chip up. Now, this is the rope that we saw for the first time in the games a season ago on that climbing snail that had the rope climbs in it. You have to go legless until you can grip your feet, make the touch. Last year, we saw some costly no reps. I know Easy got a no rep in the final event last year up in Dallas. Of course, we all remember Jeff Evans, no rep out in Atlanta, the Atlantic region. You have to bring that hand back down before you can regrip with the legs.
Yeah, if you're climbing this legless, you use typically the standard is you have to bring the hand back down before you grip with the legs. For today's rope, and I call that the shorty rope, you are allowed to use the legs. Some of these guys, as opposed to the teams, are going to use the legs all the way through. I don't think anyone would attack all these legless. You just get too burnt out.
Matt Strand is taking the lead now. On the ropes, he is followed by Andrew Primo, who we talked about a little bit yesterday, and Grant Melrose. Again, those are your top three right now. As you see Matt Strand in the all black, and we do thank Matt Strand infinitely for putting his name on the back of his T-shirt. And when you have 50 men, 50 females, and not wearing official games jerseys like they do in the game. You guys put your name on there. That helps us a lot to identify. I know the guys and the females back at the local boxes enjoy hearing the athletes' names.
Yeah, and it sounds a lot better than gray shirt, black bottoms.
Got a 16-minute time cap here in event number three.
Watching these guys move through these rope climbs, one of the things I kind of like is the fact that they actually do have to move that marker on that rogue rig as they complete reps of the rope climb. That's kind of a built-in rest counter. You know, you walk over, you move the marker, then it's time to get back down on the rope. You don't want to waste time getting lost in the bottom of that chalk bucket because, damn, it's deep.
This event reminds me somewhat. Of course, there are some different movements. The only thing similar are the wall balls, but to the 2014 regionals when you guys did the 50s, because if there's something you don't like going forward, well, after the rope climbs, and that year it was the ring dips, you got to go back and do it again.
Yeah, sometimes that's the nice thing about these workouts, and especially chippers, is once you're done with one movement, you don't have to do it again. Here, Dave Castro threw these guys a curveball and said, well, you know what, after you finish these rope climbs, go revisit all the nightmares you had on the first way down.
Again, you've got Strand in the lead, followed by Primo, and in third place right now is Belrose.
We see Strand moving back to the wall ball. Now, this is the point in the workout where you're gonna, I think you'll see some bigger separation. How do they handle these 50 wall ball on the back end? That's 100 total with 30 pounds. That's a whole lot of reps with that weight.
A lot going on as the majority of the athletes in their 10 rope climbs, and down there amongst the athletes is Nick Zielinski.
Thanks, Jeff. Got a chance to chat with Grant Belrose of 936 CrossFit. He's 25th place coming into this event, and he quoted and said, this is the worst event of the entire weekend. Grant's goal as he ran through it in practice said today is just to go ahead and get this thing finished. We talked a little bit of strategy, and Grant told me this workout doesn't even start until you finish these rope climbs. James, you just mentioned it. Those 50 wall balls on the back end, 100 total wall balls with 30 pounds. Grant's just going into complete survival mode towards the second half of this workout. But Grant Belrose, I got to keep your eye on as we go to the second half of this event.
Thank you very much, Nick. As the majority of athletes trying to get through these rope climbs, we have a few back of the wall balls.
You see Belrose shaking his head after he hopped down after that last rep. He's doing a nice job of getting those first two legless pulls and then finally getting the feet up there. I'd like to see him sort of ball up more, get those knees closer to the elbows in order to get his feet in a better position for that footlock. You see there he kind of had a little mistake. That's the problem with that shorty rope. It gets in the way in times you do not want it to.
One thing about this rope as well, because fortunate enough to be at a box, it doesn't have the shorty rope, but one of the ropes does hang off the floor. You have the long ropes at your gym or at your box, and you have 4 or 5 feet. It really does hold that rope kind of steady. You get on a rope that's not touching the ground, that first jump, all of a sudden, you're kind of wheeling around on a 360 at times.
It makes a lot different. It makes it a, kind of a lot more unstable in a sense, and you got to be more aware of where that thing is. Sometimes on the rope, slow is smooth, smooth is fast. Being frantic on that doesn't always play out well.
Little shift in the top three, it looks like, as Primo now in the lead. He is followed by Matt Strand and Grant Belrose. They're in lane number 8 in the green top and the multicolored short. Gustin Garavaglia out of Adomas CrossFit in Buenos Aires, Argentina. 29-year-old, 45th in the South a year ago. So we talked about, yeah, it's going to be very difficult for these guys to make it to the final heat. But a guy back in 2015 that finished 45th, already jumping up into the middle of the pack, that's a great improvement. And just we talk about measurable and repeatable where he's come from 2 years ago.
Yeah, I always think that is amazing, the consistency when athletes show up to regionals across a couple of years. And I think they learn a lot from this weekend. You walk away, no matter where you finish, knowing exactly what you're good at, knowing exactly what you're bad at, and how should I proceed forward.
Anderon Primo, in front of your screen with the gray shorts. He is from Sao Paulo, Brazil. CrossFit Baru, a 22-year-old, 18 a year ago here in the South. He missed it in 2015. Been a 24th in the old Latin American regional back in 2014, a judo background. And here comes Matt Strand. He is done with the shirt. It's time to get serious. Strand beginning the double unders. He is on his way back, and he's moving pretty well because he's got the 100 double unders. Then he just has to do the 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge. I say that, just do it. He's doing it with an 80-pound dumbbell over his head.
he is moving really well here. And the double unders at this moment in the workout, you know, having tested this, the double unders do not feel nice. Your shoulders burn, you're out of breath, but truly, this is kind of a mental test for him. He probably won't have any physical mess ups. It's just, does he want to stop? Getting through these unbroken will give him a little bit of edge and probably just help him propel him to the top of this heat.
Taking his time, that's a smart play on the double unders. You try to get back on them sometime, especially if you're out of breath. That's when you start tripping. Just take an extra 3 or 4 seconds, gather yourself. They're frustrating enough to do for the general community, and even your upper level athletes that we see at regionals, once you have a lot of fatigue on you. And he's going to be joined by Primo in the gray shorts. Right now it's Strain and Primo, the two athletes on their second set of 100 double unders. He's done with the 100 double unders. He'll chalk up and find that dumbbell. Again, the dumbbell's got to stay on that black mat even with the double unders. I know the athletes asked, is there going to be enough room? So they demoed that for those guys on Thursday night.
That's one of those things in competition that I think really changes for some athletes who are so used to having their own perfect little setup at home for the open or their training environments. Everything's put in just the right place to make it easier for them. Regionals kind of throws a wrench into that. Not only do you have to be fit, you got to be able to accommodate things on the spot and just be willing to make changes. That can throw a lot of people off. It seems little. We don't always notice it, but it's ever present for these guys throughout the weekend.
You see the dotted lines, the solid lines. The increments are coming in the solid lines. Your foot has to come completely across whatever line you're getting across, much like we did in the open. Connor McDonald, again, the time to beat at 1504.01. But you remember 17.2 dumbbell walking lunges. You're able to place them over your shoulders. But still, the standard was the entire foot had to come across that line, or it's a no rep, and nobody wants, whether it's two dumbbells or one, to have to go back 5 feet. 5 feet's a lot when you're doing a lunge.
A whole lot, especially when that thing is 80 pounds over your head on a single arm.
3 minutes. He's nearing the end, and he will have the heat win. We'll have to put it down. Again, he is going to have first place overall here in the South. He will crush the 15:01.04 set by Connor McDonald earlier. So Matt Strand is in. Really nice time. Just under 13 and a half minutes unofficially. So Andrew Primo will be our next athlete to make his way in. He is about halfway down the lane. He is on the left side of your screen. On the right side in lane number 3, that is Grant Belrose, who's been in the top 3 this entire event. 18th out of the South Central at a 9.36 CrossFit in Center, Texas, a 25-year-old on the right side of the black shorts.
It's important to note here, as we see Andrew and Primo get that dumbbell up on his right arm now, he was originally carrying it overhead in that left arm. You don't have to do the entire length on any one arm. You can switch as needed. However, if you do make that switch, you have to come back down to that whatever line that you haven't stepped over before you make that switch.
Well, as I like to tell the athletes, if you're going to do something with one arm overhead or anything, may as well switch evenly. Summer's coming up. Want to be symmetrical.
Yeah, got to build that beach body in the right way. You see Andrew and Primo getting called back to that line as he drops that dumbbell.
Lanes 1 and 2, Gilson Duarte on the left side of the yellow and the red. On the right is Lance Castle, CrossFit Albuquerque and Albuquerque, New Mexico, 3-time regional vet. Duarte on the left side, he is a regional rookie out of Centaurus CrossFit in Brasilia, Brazil. Primo on the right, just about done with this overhead lunge. And Primo gets the dumbbell across. And remember, you got to be careful. He did drop it, but he got it just below the waist. You don't want to get any kind of no rep. Grant Belrose making his way on the screen. He is well past the halfway point. He is nearing the end. He needs to get that thing back up because he's got just about 30 seconds until the 16-minute time cap.
And you see these guys fighting through on that first length of that overhead walking lunge when they came down before, when they were fresh, it looked so easy. Now we see these guys shaky leg, the old banana back showing up. It just is a testament to how much destruction the rest of this workout does in the upper body, the wall balls on the shoulders, and those rope climbs.
Primo on the green mat. He will walk it across. He will get in under, or rather, Belrose, excuse me, just under the time cap that's a bounce ahead. So Grant Belrose, big thumbs up as Grant Belrose out of Center, Texas, is in. So we saw Strand, Primo, and Belrose get in under the time cap here in heat number three of event number three. But Matt Strand really good, right around 13 and a half minutes unofficially, set a really nice pace.
I think what we were looking for here on Matt Strand, I think he did a good job of this. He kept a minimum rest on the wall ball even as things got tired. He moved pretty smoothly on that rope climb, having, again, a consistent rest pace there, not messing around too much with any legless stuff all the way up to the top. And then finally, he didn't let himself get out of hand on the way back. He got those jump ropes, pretty large sets. I think he had three sets on that last set of 100, but they were really big sets. And then finally, getting that dumbbell just those last few steps over that 100-foot overhead walking lunge.
So again, 13 and a half unofficially for Matt Strand. He'll tell Nick how he did it.
Matt Strand, the time to beat so far here in event three. I've heard guys call this the worst event of the weekend. Why was it so good for you?
Rope climbs, man. It's all about rope climbs. In 2014, we did that RUM rope climb workout, and I exceeded well in that one, and it has ever since given me confidence. I've loved rope climbs. I knew that was a strength. If I could get through those quick, the rest of it would flow pretty smooth. Just get through the rest and... yeah, I mean, it was a ton of fun. That was one of my favorite workouts for the weekend. So,
it looked like it. Matt Strand, great job, man. Time to beat here in event three. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Matt Strand in heat three did set a pretty good pace here. I mean, he knocked off the time to beat by over a minute and a half unofficially. So that's going to put a little pressure on heats four and five.
Yeah, Matt Strand's a really good athlete. You know, I had the pleasure of competing against him last year on the team side when he was up at Timberwolf CrossFit. He's had a lot of experience there, successful experience. Now here he is doing some good work on the individual side. We'll see if these Heat 4 athletes can chase down his time.
For all the official times, leaderboards, and all the information about not just what's going on here in the South, but what's happening over in the East, go to games.crossfit.com. Heat 4 coming up in just a matter of moments from the Alamo Dome in San Antonio. It is going to be heat number four of event number three on day two of the CrossFit South Regional in San Antonio, Texas, inside the Alamo Dome. I'm Jeff Brightwood alongside James Hobart. We'll be joined later by Nick Zielinski on the competition floor. And it's going to be a 16-minute chipper for these athletes that we just saw in heat three. And right now, these athletes have to meet a pretty good time of about 13:30.
Yeah, they'll be chasing down Matt Strand's time. And like Matt said, I do think this is a lot about the rope climbs. Same kind of issue we saw with the team's attack, the push, press, worm, rope climb. You can lose a lot of time there resting too much.
So a lot going on within the 16 minutes as we take a look at the athletes across the floor. And as you notice, in lane number nine, Michael McKinnon now is out of competition. So we'll have nine athletes here in heat number four. And they'll start it off with the 100-foot dumbbell overhead walking lunge. The community, if you are actually open this year, use the 50-pound dumbbell for the males. It's another 30 pounds on this dumbbell.
And keep in mind here, you know, before we see the end of this workout, how quickly these guys are eating this first 100-foot overhead walking lunge alive. once they finish all the stuff in the middle, they're going to have to come back to this to finish the workout at the end.
Marco Coppola made it look like the 35-pound dumbbell as he got down the full length of the floor and is already on his double unders in under a minute.
Marco Coppola is amazing. He's literally has the highest lift numbers out of any regionals athlete on the planet. Boasts over a 400-pound clean and jerk, over a 300-pound snatch. The guy is a one-man wrecking ball.
Most of the athletes starting to get across the red line, and again, 100 double unders. Rope, as you know, if you're part of CrossFit, if you train the CrossFit methodology, you know, two times under the feet. A lot more taxing. It's not like you're in elementary school just jumping rope out on the playground.
And things start to happen as you get more exhausted with the double under. These guys are really moving well here, but as they get tired, you don't always take note that a change in an inch and a half of your jump could screw up that rep, and sometimes a screw up in a double under throws you off completely when that heart rate's too high.
Marco Coppola really impressing me here in this event. Raced down on the overhead lunge, ripped through the double unders, and now already on the wall balls. And now let's head down to the floor with Nick Zielinski.
Yeah, guys, I had a chance to talk with Games qualifier from last year, Sean Sweeney. Sean had some difficulty in event two yesterday, which dropped him from sixth place in event one. He now sits in 19th place. He went on to Instagram last night, and I asked him to kind of explain what he wanted to say on Instagram. Essentially, it said he doesn't blame the judge. He's got to put it in the past, and he's got to move forward. Sean's no stranger to moving up on these weekends, especially on Saturdays. Last year, he made a big jump. The year before, he made a big jump on Saturday into the top 10. I asked him what he's got to do today to make sure he does make that big jump and move back into contention for a game spot. And I can't exactly quote what Sean told me, but I'll give you the gist of what he said. He's got to freaking win. I'll give you... use your imagination for the actual word that he'd really use. But Sean Sweeney, a man to watch, sitting in 19th place over there in lane one.
Thanks a lot, Nick. And again, Sean Sweeney on the left side of your screen, shirtless with the gray shorts, starting on his wall balls. And might have a strategy for this. He is not one of the early guys to get on those wall balls, but it may be a matter of let me get on the ropes and then throttle up for the sprint on the way back.
You know, with a 6th and a 44th place finish, Sean has his work cut out for him to get in that top 5 spot. We saw him at the end of that ring dip workout yesterday kind of mouthing, you know, I'm out. But he's been to the games before. He's been in this position before. One of his best events at the games last year was the climbing worm, where it was essentially a lot of grunt work with some funky rope climbs. So if there is a guy who can climb back out of this hole, he is the guy to do it today, so we'll keep our eyes on him.
See the empty lane in lane number 9. Michael McKenna injured yesterday. He is out of the competition. He was from Scorpion CrossFit in Chandler, Arizona, so we wish him the best. That is the reason for the empty lane in lane number 9. Back to the competition here, and this is really where this event, James, is won or lost on your rope climbs. And again, this is the rope that we saw for the first time a year ago as Marco Coppola, 16th overall, coming into event number 3, and he is really setting a very, very nice pace. But this rope came into play a year ago in Carson at the soccer stadium.
Yeah, we're seeing Marco make a pretty easy time of it. 6 foot, 225 pounds. He doesn't have to jump too far to get all the way up that rope. I think what's really interesting about him, he was 5th place in the 2015 USA Weightlifting National Champions in the 105 kilogram plus group. It's cool to see a guy like that who had such an amazing specialty come out here and apply his fitness in this way, and he's doing pretty well so far. Let's see if he can hang on in the back half of this workout.
And again, 31st in the team division a year ago, so you competed on the same floor with him. He was on CrossFit Overtakes team.
That's the kind of guy you want on a team, because sometimes it helps to have some specialists there when something big and heavy like that big bobsled we see at the games has to be moved. That's the guy you want pushing it.
Mass moves mass.
Oh, it does.
Marco Coppola still in first and second. Guillermo Dominguez out of CrossFit Iron Soldier in Rio Grande do Sul, Brazil, and in third place again is Dominguez. Actually, it was Sweeney that overtook Dominguez, so Sweeney beginning to make a little bit of a move on the left side of your screen.
And like you talked about earlier, maybe this is where that experience pays off. Sweeney's having a nice job finding a rhythm. He goes back, moves that marker up the rogue rig, and then turns around and gets right back on the rope. He doesn't seem to be wasting any extra time resting. Someone once told me as soon as you reach for chalk, you've lost the race. And I like that I see Sweeney ignoring that chalk bucket right now.
I'm not going to lie to you. Since you mentioned that, I've lost a lot of races inside the box. You watch these athletes, amazing. It's hard because it's relevant. You're looking at 10 of the fittest individuals on the planet, and then the best of the best go to Madison, Wisconsin for the games. A lot different than you know, you can watch this at home and say, they're going too slow, I reach for the chalk, and here they are going at a very rapid pace. You're welcome to scale it and test it out at your box. This is a very, very tough event.
Yeah, the only other people who could go faster than them are the people who are beating them in this workout. It's easy to say otherwise when you're sitting back in your computer chair watching it from home.
Sweeney quickly moves the marker. He's got a little circle he does, makes the turn, moves the marker, about two steps, turns, and goes.
And it's really hard to have that kind of discipline because your heart rate's up, you're getting a little tired, you feel your grip slip, and you think to yourself, hey, maybe I do need a little bit of chalk. In most cases, you don't.
He's overtaking Copeland now because he moved that marker up to the 10. Copeland now trying to get some air in those lungs and taking that familiar, we've all seen it, that long look up the ropes. And here is Sweeney, 25 wall balls on the right target, the next 25 on the left target. That's how you're going to monitor his progress. Seven minutes into the 16-minute time cap.
Sweeney has about a 7-rep lead right now on Coppola, but does Coppola's size, even though he's winded, give him the extra edge on these wall balls? Who gets the bigger set? Who moves over to that left target for that next set of 25 faster?
Now, tall guys, usually not the big fans of the running, diving into the bar and Olympic lifts, but boy, tall guys lock the wall balls just to piston, go down and reach up. And if you've got good form and you can keep those hands under the med ball and vault it up instead of clamping down on the side, provides a huge, huge advantage. That's really, I mean, you would expect great technique from a regional and a games athlete.
Yeah, and we see Sweeney taking a no rep there. Might have been on the depth. Otherwise, it looks like he's moving well. Heels are staying down, pushing those knees out. He's strong enough where he's not having yet to jump to get that wobble up to that 10-foot target, and that helps save some energy. There you see it on that last rep, that little jump. We saw a lot of athletes earlier relying on that for multiple reps. You want to stay away from that if you can because it expends extra energy.
So Marco Coppola may have jumped Sweeney here. Coppola on the right side of your screen, Sean. Sweeney on the left side of your screen, a 30th place finished a year ago in Carson at the CrossFit Games. Coppola on the right side.
Coppola taking some big sets, but also big rest. There are instances where small sets, small rest does pay off. Sweeney looks like he is fighting to get everything he has here to try and get up away from those wall balls.
And they're on the last 25 wall balls. They move back to that left target. Left on their left, on your right, watching at home. And Matt Strand had a 13. It was 13:24.46, so a little bit quicker than the unofficial 13:30 that it looked like initially. So Matt Strand has set a really good pace here for these last two heats. Sweeney again pacing out the first half until he got to the rope climbs, and that it's really paying off. Remember how quick Marco Coppola was.
And as you see Sweeney look down at that ball, that's that moment in the workout where you said to yourself earlier today, what do you got to do? I got to win. When he's staring at that thing, that's what he's telling himself over and over again, is I have to pick this up. This is that moment where he can make a difference here as we see Coppola now moving back to the double unders.
Sweeney right behind him. So Sweeney and Coppola, that's your race for first. Looks like Richie and Dominguez have a little bit of a battle for third place right now in the heat.
See Sweeney at the top of your screen, bending over, hook gripping those shorts. Yeah, and now he finally starts up, gets into those double unders. He needs 100 here in a row.
Coppola tripped early on into his set of 100 double unders. So Coppola on the forefront, and he's having some trouble. Sweeney looks pretty comfortable down there, as comfortable as you can be at this point.
Chase down, Strand, he set the time to be with 13:23.
So now both athletes, both Coppola in the forefront and Sweeney in the background, trying to eat these up in as big of a set as you possibly can.
This is going to be a gritty race to the finish here, and sometimes as hard as it is, when you break, when you rest, you want to stay away from that crouched over position. There's a few positions where it's harder to breathe than that. You want to try and stay upright, even if you're not moving. It's going to be easier to take in some air.
Waiting for a hand to go up, either from Sweeney's judge or Coppola's judge. Point of all the movements, I think you have to judge double unders to be are pretty difficult. Less than five here for Coppola. He is done. If he moves the dumbbell like he did at the start of the event, and that's when he is fresh, he is going to have a good opportunity to be in first, but he will not have the event record overall. Matt Frazier, 11:17.02. That's coming up in 10 seconds.
You see Coppola, the old pocket full of chalk trick. You know, again, that simple stuff. If you know chalk, he's going to be your comfort. He can help you. And look at him ripping through these overhead walking lunges.
Sweeney had about a one-step lead very briefly as he picked it up immediately. But Coppola, even though he showed some fatigue in the wall balls and the double unders, he's still moving relatively quick here in this one-arm overhead lunge. Doing a little bit of a balance issue there, but he is able to stay upright. Sweeney in the background, about 10 feet behind. And now Coppola reopens up that lead and going to make him steady himself. Sweeney with the dumbbell down on the floor. Coppola continues to inch closer and closer to the green mat, but he will have to carry that dumbbell onto the red mat for the time to be complete. And he's going to have a new time to beat by over a minute once he gets on the finish mat. And Marco Coppola, about 12:17 unofficially, that will surpass Matt Strand's 13:24.
And right now, Sweeney has to stay in his own lane. He might not have won this heat from Coppola, but there's still one more heat of athletes to go. His score could still really bump him up a lot if he finishes strong here. He needs to push through, keeping that dumbbell overhead in these last couple steps.
One more step for Sean Sweeney. And we'll just carry it on over onto the red mat, 12:43. It's going to be good enough for second overall in the South right now. So did what he had to do. He needed a top three as we go back to Kirk Ritchie. Ritchie at a Cityside CrossFit in Houston, Texas, 17th out of the South Central, a 24-year-old rookie.
And pretty consistent so far from Kirk Ritchie as a 16th. And 11th as he comes into event three right here. And he looks like he's moving pretty smooth on those double unders. And as soon as I say that, he takes a little break.
Ritchie in a battle for third with Guillermo Dominguez. As you see, he is there in the black shorts. CrossFit Iron Soldier in Rio Grande do Sul, Brazil. 27-year-old. He was 34th in the regionals a year ago here in the South. So he is trying to improve on that 34th place finish from a season ago.
And you see some different things from both of these athletes. You see on Guillermo, his hands are out a little farther. On Kirk Ritchie, hands are in a little closer. On the double under, as you get tired, you want to try and pull those hands in, because as the hand squat wider, the rope shortens, you're more likely to have a trip up there. Once fatigue sets in, sometimes that's harder to control. And here we see Kirk moving on to the overhead walk and lunge.
And you've talked about how the different athletes study that overhead. We see the heads of the dumbbell from some from side to side like Ritchie does. Some like to turn that wrist, torque it, you know, show that armpit, and it'll go forwards to backwards. Just however you feel the most comfortable.
Yeah, personally for me, I like to have it where the palm faces my body, so the left palm would be facing in toward my left. I think the way Kirk is doing it is a little bit more difficult, but, you know, he just knocked out about 50 feet there, not having too much trouble with it.
Dominguez will begin his dumbbell lunge in 1 point. Now, performance on this we've not mentioned. When you're doing this lunge, remember, don't short those steps. You have to come up, open that hip fully all the way at the top. Can't do the little modified duck walk to get down the lane quicker.
Yeah, kind of like the same way you got to stand up all the way from the bottom of the air squat. You got to make sure the body is nice and straight as you step up from that lunge.
Kirk Ritchie in the gray shorts in the middle of your screen off to the left. At 15:07, he won't have a top three overall, but he's going to have one of the better times If he can get under 15:26, that should be good enough for sixth or seventh so far through about 3.5 heats. So he's going to have a top 10 overall time so far with one heat remaining.
Jared Enderton showing us why it's never too late to make a comeback here. Struggled on the wall ball, but now on those overhead walking lunge past Guillerme, looks like he's going to go unbroken. Sometimes having that extra strength can really help you out.
Well, this rolls right into his wheelhouse. A straight guy, Olympic lifter, 80 pound dumbbell. Let's see if he can finish it off. He's a few steps. If he can get to the green mat, you have to get to the U-Rat. I think he just beat the time cap. Great job. Great effort by Jared Enderton out of CrossFit Pandora's Box in Colorado Springs, Colorado.
That was cool. Unbroken overhead walking lunge on the backside of that workout. That's not just strength, that's grit. He had to tell himself he wanted to do that. Strong kid, strong beard.
That was amazing to watch. Jared Enderton, who was 22nd in the South a year ago. Former wrestler, strongman, weightlifting, a little bit of everything.
Both Marco and Sweeney here kind of going head-to-head throughout the first half of this workout. Sweeney's strategy paid off. He was eased into this workout, and he dominated those rope climbs, got back through the wall balls. He and Marco got back to the overhead walking lunge at about the same time, but I think it was Marco's strength once they moved through the wall ball and the double under. It was Marco's strength on those overhead walking lunges that just allowed him to edge out Sweeney. But who knows, both laid down some strong times. Is that going to be enough for Sweeney to push back up into striking distance of the top five to go back to the games? Really nice finish there by Marco.
Let's head to the floor with Nick Zielinski.
Marco, a lot of guys have talked about how bad this event is. You pick up your dumbbell. Sean Sweeney picks up his dumbbell for that last lunge. Could you feel him on your heels there?
I try not to pay attention to the other guys when I'm going that much. Use it for a push. But honestly, on the lunge, I know I'm pretty good at doing lunges like that, anything overhead. So it was more of, I heard the announcer say that he picked it up. And I was like, okay, make sure it's time to go. And I'm going to try to do this in at least one longer and a shorter segment. Only put it down once. So that worked. So I couldn't be upset about that.
You set the time to beat here in event three. You got one more event for the day. To get yourself back up that leaderboard, what do you have to accomplish in event four?
Well, event four is, it's going to be quick for a lot of people. So I need to move. I need to, you know, it's body weight movements with the handstand walk and the total bars. So I need to make sure I stay moving on those and control my sets and get zero faults and no reps or whatever you want to call them. Don't get called back. And then on the deadlifts, same thing. Really important I don't do extra reps. Make sure everything's crisp to give myself a shot to finish well.
Marco, congratulations. Thank you very much.
Marco Coppola now has the time to beat in the South in event number three. And we have one final heat to go. Here is heat number five as athletes coming onto the floor. I'm Jeff Breivel alongside James Hobart. Also joined today by Nick Zielinski here in the South Regional. Final heat here, James, and two of the guys we're watching, Travis Williams and Logan Collins.
Absolutely. Travis Williams right now turning into Mr. Consistent as we head into this longer workout here. He has a second and a sixth so far. I'm sure he wants to push past Logan into that first place position, but Logan, similar to third place and a third place, really showing us how well-rounded he is as he tries to fight back for the games.
And they have battled back and forth the last few years as we take a look at Travis Williams in lane number six out of UCAN CrossFit in League City, Texas.
I've really been impressed with Travis's growth over the last couple of years. Last year when I talked to him before the games, you know, he's a barbell guy, but he said, hey, I'm sick of being bad at the long stuff. I really want to get better at the Murph, and he did. He improved on his Murph at the games last year. I'd like to see him come out on top in this event so he can show us just how much he's improved on those weaknesses, and he's not just a strong barbell guy.
There's Logan Collins right next to him in the black shirt and the gray shorts. Williams in the black tank top and the white tights. Overall leader is Logan Collins. And again, Roy Gamboa being out, one of these two could be your new champion for the South.
10 seconds.
Final heat of event number three starts with 100 feet of dumbbell overhead walking lunges.
Like we've seen in the previous heats before this, you'll see these athletes fresh. The 80-pound dumbbell, though heavy, not a huge issue for them. They're going to move through this first 100-foot walking lunge quickly as they move to their first set of 100 double-unders.
Easy Muhammad in the gray shirt and the darker gray shorts. Big strength numbers and those long legs, was leading the lunge, but had to stop to switch arms. Again, the legs and the strength help, those long arms trying to balance that dumbbell, that kind of throws a wrench into things.
Yeah, longer limbs on the overhead walking lunge and a couple of other different movements might make some things more difficult, but I think Easy's bread and butter is coming in the middle of this workout, which for most of these athletes has been the sticking point. We haven't seen the best from him yet, I believe, in this workout.
He broke it about 40 feet, but he was good enough to catch up with Travis Williams, and he and Travis were the first two across the red line to get onto the double unders.
This is another nice point on how you cannot get too caught up in what other people are doing, and sometimes if you have a plan, race your own race, play to your own strength. Don't play to somebody else's.
There is Easy Muhammad out of This Is CrossFit Unorthodox in Las Vegas, Nevada. He used to be down in the Southeast region, competing in the Atlantic Regional back in 2015. Out of that region, he qualified for the games with a third place finish in the Atlantic a year ago, had a chance, but just missed out with a sixth place finish. But on a good show in 2015, his 16th place finish in his rookie debut at the CrossFit Games.
Easy's another one of those athletes who has the capability to win workouts outright, especially the more specialized they are. But as we saw yesterday, 13th in that longer bodyweight movement workout with the vest, looks like he's been working on his weaknesses.
I don't care if you're a regional, a games athlete, or just someone in the box, to be so relaxed like Easy was to just kind of look around and check the other athletes and the judge out to see where he was. It's pretty good composure.
And like you said, multiple time regional competitor, that experience helps make you a little bit more comfortable just to, hey, is my plan going on track? Let me take a look around and see.
As we look down the competition for Brandon Luckett, unaffiliated in the forefront, a physics student at LSU. Next to him in the black shirt is Zachary Moran out of CrossFit Tempe in Tempe, Arizona. Again, used to be up in the East, was a Division I wrestler up at Sacred Heart.
Moran having a pretty good showing this week in a 27th, and then yesterday with an event win as that first 18th place overall in the open for students. Pretty impressive athlete. We'll see if that extra gas you get from being a wrestler can help carry him through this workout.
50 wall balls. You see two different targets in each lane. The first 25 on the left target, the second 25 on the right target. That'll help you keep up at home with their progress. Travis Williams right now in the lead, followed by Easy Muhammad and Tommy Venus at a Zero Machine CrossFit in Phoenix. Venus trying to make a name for himself here in his first regional, and he's doing just that already in the final heat.
Yeah, Venus, one of three Zero Machine CrossFit athletes competing here this weekend. He struggled compared to his other regional competitors, had a slower time in 17.1, that longer dumbbell snatch burpee box jump workout, which you might call more breathy, similar to this workout. I'm curious to see how this plays out for him.
Well, if Easy moves through these wall balls and gets to the ropes, that's where he could really separate, even from a Travis Williams, a very tall athlete, basketball background, that jumping ability that we have seen him show off in several regionals and the games. Doesn't take a lot of pulls for Easy to get to the top of that rig.
No, and there you see him move to the rope. He's really kind of taken off in this event. Like you said, hey, maybe a little slower on those overhead walking lunges. But that's not where Easy's going to excel. It's going to be here on the wall ball and those rope climbs. He's already two in.
Just a couple of pulls that takes for Easy Muhammad down on the competition floor. Also on the floor is Nick Zielinski.
Yeah, guys, one person to keep an eye on here in this event is going to be Joseph Gesser, the man right behind me. He comes into this event sitting in eighth place. He had a little bit of a misstep in event one, finishing in 25th, but his second place finish in event two brought him back up the leaderboard. I talked to his training partner and kind of coach, Richard Bolkin, who's a games athlete himself. A lot of games experience thinking about these events. He said Gessner feels great, he looks great, he's not sore at all, he's looking for him to make a big move here in event three. Like I said, a lot good minds working together for Gessner here in Vulcan. Watch for Joseph Gessner to make a move here on Easy Muhammad.
Gessner, a year ago, 36 at the Games. He was at the Games in 2015 on CrossFit Lubbock's team, where he was at back in 2015, where they finished 35th. Right now, trains at a Double T CrossFit in Lubbock, Texas. Watching Easy Muhammad right next to him move that chip up into rep number 7. Takes about one pull for him to be able to wrap his legs around that rope. Lane number 9 again, that's Joseph Gessner, 14th out of the South Central, former amateur MMA fighter. Just got in a year ago and finished 36th at the Games. So that's Gessner on the left side of the black top, Easy Muhammad off to the right in the gray t-shirt. Muhammad with 2 climbs to go. So the last one coming up for Easy, and then he is on his way back down the floor with 50 wall balls, 100 double unders, the 100-foot overhead dumbbell lunge. Big deep breath and another component that will favor a taller athlete, and it's the wall ball. He just blew through him and got through the 10 rope climb. So now Muhammad, see how quickly he can get back. You see Logan Collins also on the wall ball. Travis Williams still on his rope climbs, but Logan Collins and Easy Muhammad kind of battling out here on the wall balls, their first set of 25.
Easy was a little faster back to that wall ball, no surprise. Kind of taking a casual sip of water there, taking a peek over at Logan Collins. Hey, is it time for me to go yet?
That's composure, and you just kind of get you a sip out of the shaker and get back on it. Marco Coppola had a 12:18.18 here in the South. Again, Matt Frazier, the 11:17 up in the East. Joseph Gessner again in lane number 9.
Really impressed too with Tommy Venus. Right off the Easy's left, right here, quietly working away, chipping away at those wall balls, staying a pretty close pace with him and Logan Collins.
Nearing the 8-minute mark here, again, a 16-minute time cap as Muhammad moves the wall ball to his left. That means he has 25 reps remaining on the wall ball. Logan Collins on the right side, Travis Williams on the left. Two of the favorites to potentially supplant Roy Gamboa, and they are doing their part so far here in the South.
One of the things you might not think about here is that we have to move from target to target. Each target you have to accumulate 25 reps. So if you're on your right target and you get to, let's say, 22 reps and stop, that means you have to do 3 more reps and then stop again before you move over. There could be a smarter choice for how these guys break up these reps. Maybe it's 2 large sets or something like that. You don't want to be splitting up sets into really small reps. There's a lot of time wasted there.
We just passed the 8:40 mark. That is where Matt Frazier completed his 50 wall balls and his event record. So these athletes here, although they're setting a really good pace, and we were going to kind of keep an eye on Easy Muhammad or a little bit off that world record pace, but they're on track here to potentially get first overall here in the South. Marco Coppola, we just saw that 12:18.
We know how much Easy really needs a strong showing here to continually chisel his way back up to that 5th place position and put some distance between him and those 6th and 7th place guys. Only about 11 points separating 5th from 7th place right now.
Muhammad on the right, down to his last 5, under 5 wall balls to go. As Easy will make the turn, so he has 201 total reps, his 100 double unders, the 100-foot overhead lunge, then the rep to get onto the finish mat.
No surprise, Logan Collins making a strong name for himself again here this week. And as he grabs his rope, takes a couple breaths, you want to give yourself that moment of composure. And look how fast Logan Collins cycles those double unders. You think double unders only have one gear? He's giving you another reason to think that they have multiple. He's quick off the ground, and that rope is moving fast.
Logan Collins taking a look around. He's behind me checking with his judge to see where exactly he may be. But Logan Collins looks really relaxed to be on the back half of this of the 100 double unders. I don't believe he's had to break yet. Quick peek to his left to look down the competition floor to Easy Muhammad. And Tommy Venus joins the party as well. And it's Dakota Ranger, the rookie that jumped out on the scene yesterday.
Again, it just goes to show you how important the back half of this workout is. Dakota, like I said, he's one of those guys who attacks a lot of volume in his own training. He showed us some effort yesterday, and he's got a lot of gas to go, in that first event. He's got a lot of gas to go long in these more metabolic workouts.
Well, here comes Easy Muhammad. He'll be the first on the dumbbells. Logan Collins chalking up in the background, and we'll see if Logan Collins can track down Easy Muhammad. Again, 12:18.18, the time to beat here in the South.
We saw Jared Enderton do it in the heat before. Can any of these athletes here keep that dumbbell overhead to get this thing unbroken? You see Easy take a quick check over to Logan Collins. Notice he's creeping up on him. Realize, oh, wait, I can't pause right now. I don't have that much cushion.
Remember, Easy broke it about that distance on the first 100-foot walking lunge. Was in first, fell to the back, and then ended up tying Travis Williams back in first. Those long legs and his strength.
You hear so many athletes talk about how you can't pay attention to what anybody else does. But let me tell you, there are times when if you do not, it will cost you dearly. Easy took advantage of that. It's not the end of the world if you look over and somebody's creeping up, but it means you got to move.
28 seconds. Boy, it's going fast down to 18 seconds of Easy Muhammad. What's the time to beat here? Collins right behind him in the middle of your screen. Muhammad on the lower part of your screen. One more step for Easy Muhammad. He's got to get to the finish, Matt, and in right around 12:15. Logan Collins will be in at about 12:19, so he should have third overall here in this event. So Easy Muhammad, once we wait for the official numbers, but unofficially should have the top time here in the South. Big 100 points for Easy Muhammad. Lane 7, Tommy Venus had to take a step back. There's Dakota Ranger in the white shirt.
And that might have cost Tommy Venus, but who knows here? It's close.
They got to get to the red, and it's going to be Venus. They got into the green right about the time Venus able to keep his footing and get to the finish mat. Still not bad for Dakota Ranger. Here's Travis Williams, a little bit behind the pack here in the final heat. Already over 13 minutes, but if you look at the overall times, he's going to be fine. Coming into heat number 5, fourth place was 15:04. He should be able to get in under 15, no trouble. So it's not as bad, really, as it might look relative to this heat. Overall, Travis thinks is going to be just fine.
I do, too. I think he'll be strong in the other events remaining today. Looking at him now, this might be his weakest event, but I know he's got more in the tank for the rest of the weekend. He's got that experience to say, hey, we had a hiccup. How do we recover from that? We focus on the next event.
Joseph Gessler collapses onto the finish mat. Those wall balls going back took a lot out of him. He kind of collapsed before he got on, had to take a knee before his double unders. But they did everything he could to finish up this event. And again, Gessler's going to be fine as well. Here is Travis Williams trying to make that giant step. He's going to have to make one more step because the heel's on the red line. He will get onto the mat at 14:12. Over on lane number 2, Zachary Moran is in. Cooper Wise and Zachary Moran. And it looks like we may have just one athlete remaining. Back in lane number 10, that's Alan Garcia, unaffiliated out of the Southwest, 26 years old. Was in the South the last 2 years in the Latin America regional in 12, 13, and 14. now competing out of the Southwest. On to his double unders and in lane one, that's Brandon Luckett, unaffiliated as well. He is in under the 16-minute time cap as well. So a little bit over a minute. We'll have one athlete that will not get under the time cap. That'll be Alan Garcia unless he does something really special after this set of double unders. Well, it looks like just two double unders remaining. And that is two double unders. He's got less than a minute to finish this thing out. Here comes Easy Muhammad to help him get it through. But right now, you may not get all 100 feet, but you need to get as many reps as you can. Thirty seconds for Alan Garcia to get as far as he can. He'll have another event today, so still a chance he could be in heat number five by tomorrow. But he'll have to have a pretty nice event number four this afternoon.
Absolutely. He'll have to have a strong finish in that event four here. And, you know, even though it's 10 seconds left, every rep counts here. He needs to keep pushing if he can get that dumbbell back overhead.
5 seconds to go. And he'll cap out on the overhead walking lunge. Easy Muhammad, 100 points for the games and regional veteran.
We knew he was one of the guys to watch here, and he just excelled like we expect him to on those rope climbs. Very little rest there. He started off kind of slow on the lunges on the way down. However, it was Logan Collins, that break he had on those lunges that allowed Easy to look left to right, pick up his pace, and finish just ahead of our current leader for the day, Logan Collins. Easy with a big win there. He needed that as he pushes toward the top five.
So the top time to beat, and he's with Nick Zielinski.
Easy Muhammad, quite a finish here in event three. We all know about your proficiency in the rope climbs, but what was your strategy coming into this event?
Minimal rest. So make the reps and break them up quickly and take a little rest and keep moving rather than trying to do big sets because they're simple movements. So I just broke them up a little bit more than I would like to.
Great finish for you. You sat in sixth place coming into this event. Do you watch that leaderboard at all? Do you know where you sit coming into today and going into tomorrow?
I don't. My coaches do, and my athletes that are here, my wife. So they all kind of keep me in check, like, hey, you're here, you're this many points away. But I try not to look at the leaderboard and just try to come in with the open mind of you're in dead last, you got to compete. Everybody's even, you got to compete kind of deal.
How are we feeling about handstand walks, toes to bar, and deadlifts?
Well, after this workout with these shoulders and those wall balls, I don't know really, but I feel good though, man. They're simple movements, you just got to move, and like I said, stay steady, so I feel good about it.
All right, Easy Muhammad, congratulations to Vit 3 win.
Thank you, man.
100 points in the bank for Easy Muhammad as he takes event number three here in the South. In good shape, maybe, to get back to the games. He's got three events remaining here as he does it in 12:15.52. Coppola right behind him with that 12:18. Sean Sweeney did a nice job. Needed to do well today after yesterday, and he is fourth place overall in event number three. So he racks up a good chunk of points here with one event remaining in the day.
If Sean wants to get back into that top five for the games, he's going to have to average, I think, around 80 points per finish, and that fourth place is a step in the right direction.
And that's how they stack up in event number three here at the Alamo Dome. Again, for all the official information about the standings and the athletes and the regional competitions, not only in the South but in the East, go to games.crossfit.com. For James Hobart, I'm Jeff Brightwell. This is the CrossFit South Regional from the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas.
Elijah Muhammad gets his first win of the regional competition. Welcome back inside the CrossFit Update Studios, everybody. I'm Sean Woodland with Tommy Marquez and Pat Sherwood. The South Regional on the men's side is living up to what we thought it would be. The leaderboard, I guess, always in a state of flux when it comes to the top five.
And, you know, watching that final heat there for event number three, what was the big thing heading into regionals? It's too light. The dumbbells are too light. Well, if the dumbbells are so light, how come everybody keeps putting them down on that final lunge? It looks like there's plenty of weight to go around out there. So I think these events are doing exactly what Mr. Castro intended them to.
Yeah, and it's nice to see a couple athletes like Elijah really kind of make a statement there in that workout. He was just on the outside looking in, hopefully moving up into the top five. And Logan Collins, yet another impressive performance from him.
Yeah, more on the south in a second, but let's get you caught up on the east women's competition. They got after event number three, and Caroline Reason-Tebow came into this event having won the first two, and she was right next to the woman in second place. That's Catherine David's daughter. The two of them basically even through the rope climbs, that it was David's daughter who got through the double unders first, and the two-time defending games champion picks up her first event win of the regional competition with a time of 11 minutes, 48 seconds. But Caroline Reason-Tebow would finish second. She's still on top of the overall leaderboard by 10 points over Catherine David's daughter. Carrie Pierce is in third. And then Danny Horan and Chelsea Hughes rounding out the top five. Caroline Prevost is 22 points back. Kelly Baker, 28 points back. So everybody there on the leaderboard still within striking distance, but the women outside the top five are going to need to put on a charge here through the final couple of events and also get some help. But for Catherine David's daughter, she gets her first win and is looking like she is well on her way towards returning to the CrossFit Games.
What was the most difficult part of event number three?
It's the wall bars aren't so tough the first round, but it's the rope climbs in the wall balls again. That was like when I looked it on paper, I was like, oh, this can be like a fast chipper, but it's actually so hard. And that's the part that I liked about it. It was really challenging.
So we have a couple of hours before event number four. What does your rest strategy look like?
I'll go get some work done on my body, especially my biceps right now, and my grip for event number four. So just getting ready for that.
Thanks while you get to it. Catherine David's daughter, first place, event number three.
Pretty good battle developing at the top of that leaderboard between Catherine David's daughter, and I think we expected her to be fighting with Carrie Pierce for the top spot, but Caroline Reason-Tebow continuing to impress.
Yeah, Caroline, this is not shaking out how I thought it was going to be at all, and it's a fantastic thing. I love it, and for the viewers at home, don't think, David's daughter should be winning, especially if she wants to try to win the games again. She is in incredible shape, but she's probably trying to peak for the game, so she's doing just fine.
It's great to see Caroline really kind of contending with Catherine Davis' daughter. If you remember last year, towards the end of the regional, she was right there behind Catherine and then kind of had a little bit of a fault on that last event. But then they're seeing the groups like Carrie Pierce and Danny Horan kind of battling out three and four. Chelsea Hughes trying to hold on for five. So some nice groupings there.
The women are getting set to take on event number three in the south. And again, the rope is the thing that seems to be separating people here.
Yeah, those 10 rope climbs in the middle, especially with the cut-off rope that we've only seen at the games, especially coming off of everything they just did, smoking their lungs, shoulders, and legs on the heavy wall balls. But it seems to be the rope climb, and then you got to go all through that same stuff on the way back. Event three is just a nasty, nasty event.
With that being said, really fast, who do you each like in this event?
I think Alexis Johnson is going to do very well. If I look back to what happened last year in 2016, we had an event with 104 wall balls. She did well on that. She took seventh. And we had thrusters and legless rope climbs. She took fourth on that. So given those are the crux of this movement, I think it plays well for her.
I got Margot Alvarez. I think this is a great workout for her. One, she loves wall balls. It's something that she does extremely well at. She's also one of the few athletes in this field that is familiar with that short rope. So she knows what to expect in terms of managing her energy there. Couple of legless climbs, get the feet pinched, efficiency of movement there to make sure she has enough energy to go back the other way.
For those of you watching this in San Antonio, pay attention, put down your phones, just a couple seconds here. Zevia is running a promotion for folks attending the regionals. They're offering 30% off, but you have to have a promo card. So stop by their booth, grab a promo card, and enjoy a tasty can of Zevia. It's good stuff. I can't stop drinking it myself, so it's definitely something that you're going to want to do out there. Let's get you back to San Antonio, Texas, the individual competition continuing in the South Regional. Event three up next for the women.
Reassuring them that their heart was right. And when the naysayers
30 seconds.
First look at our women's individuals for today, taking on individual event three, presented by Trifecta. It's going to be much the same as the gentlemen. In fact, exactly the same, with the exception of the weights. It's going to be a 100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge with a 55-pound dumbbell. When they arrive at the other side, 100 double unders, 50 wall ball shots with a 20-pound wall ball, 10 rope climbs, and then they'll work their way back. 50 wall balls, 100 double unders, and a second 100-foot walking lunge to finish up. Again, our first look at this division today, Saturday, our second day of competition here in the South Regional, in Alamo Dome here in San Antonio, Texas. In Brandi Hughes, the first to reach her rope. And Brandi will be the first to get started on her double unders. Brandi in lane number 7, Tough Country CrossFit. Cabrera in 2nd. Cabrera down in lane number 3.
Just joining us, this is day 2, individual event 3, presented by Trifecta. Heat 1 of the women's individual competition, the ladies working on those. Somebody's got to be making a move soon. They are Mindy Hughes in the blue tank top. First to advance in the wall balls. She'll hit 25 at the first marker, and then you'll see her move over to the next wall ball marker when she hits the halfway marker. She is joined by Costanza Cabrera in lane number 2. So it is 1 Hughes, 2 Cabrera. And then our athlete over in lane number 9.
Looks like Amanda Garces is next up on the list.
Jamie West moving into wall balls, as is Meredith Smith. The judges keeping a close eye on them. They're looking for that hip crease below the knee. And that athlete explodes up and gets the ball up to the target. That ball, excuse me, up to the target. We are 3 minutes in. This event with that 16-minute time cap. The athlete's working through 4 different movements. A little bit of a laundry list thrown at them.
Rodriguez and Lewis now delighted with the dubs and onto the wall balls. Mindy Hughes now shifting her wall ball target to the second target, as has Ferrari.
These ladies working on those wall balls, which is a pretty typical movement that you'll find within the CrossFit space. But they have a heavier ball than normal. It is 20 pounds. The unique aspect to this particular event, that short rope that you see over there, they've got to get 10 rope climbs. So they will start legless. They can obviously continue legless up to the top of the rope rig. But some of them will anchor their feet in. As we see, Mindy Hughes will give us an example of what I was talking about here. There we go. Tries to jump up as high as she can on the rope. Goes legless for a little bit and has decided to anchor in those feet to make her way to the top of the rope rig. And then on her way back down, she's got to wait till her hands pass that black marker before she can drop. So Mindy Hughes with 1 rope climb in the bag. A hand is up though for Meredith Smith and Kareem Ferrari. Ferrari finishing up her wall ball. She'll be joining Hughes onto the rope climbs. So it is 1 Hughes, then 2 Ferrari. 3 is gonna be Meredith Smith in lane number 3.
I'm on 5 minutes and 30 seconds. 60-minute time cap in place. One of these athletes will set the time or score to be. For our remaining 4 heats from individual competition for our women's division.
Hughes gets another rep. Jamie West looking to get a rep on that rope climb over in lane number 8. Smith is good, as was Ferrari's. And we hit 6 minutes in. Athletes, you are 6 minutes in.
Touching up, completing that rope climb. And they move it marker up to rep number 5. These ladies working on the rope climbs. This seems to be the most challenging aspect to this particular event, event number 3, heat 1. Ferrari working her way up, as is Chelsea Lewis, Mindy Hughes, Jamie West. There, we're about halfway to that time cap. There is 8 minutes in. Mindy Hughes. Number 7. Meredith Smith also on number 7. He's now making that ascent. We're still in there.
There you can see a lot of these ladies maybe not as comfortable with leg lifts as they'd like to be, because as soon as that bottom of the rope is within striking distance, you can see some of them actually burning a lot of time trying to lock their feet in because that upper arm strength is just smoked. Nine minutes in, athletes.
He's about to start. Rep number 8. We're going to wait through her 10 of rope climbs.
Chelsea Lewis moving that marker to 6. She's tied up with Costanza Cabrera. I see a few of these ladies with just a couple rope climbs remaining. Meredith Smith, she may be the new leader, I think. She's got one more rope climb to go. Meredith Smith is in the blue tank top, black bottoms. 10 minutes in, 6 minutes remain.
Mindy Hughes, moving her marker to number 9, she. Playing that 9 rope climb here in a second. You called it, Meredith Smith. Going ahead, and I believe with that touch, Fosbro comes up from the judge. She's good to go, and she will have completed her 10 rope climbs.
Let's get behind Meredith Smith, ladies and gentlemen. Cheer on, first athlete to those wall balls. There you go, girl.
Chelsea Lewis making up some time on for rope climbs as well as she begins rep number 9. Hughes finishing 9, moving her marker up to number 10 with 1 to go. Jamie West on 9 as well.
So Hughes was first into the rope rig, or first to the rope climbs, we should say. But Meredith Smith was able to pass her up. Hughes, though, still keeping a decent pace as she's got one more rope climb to go, like you were talking about, Larry. Meanwhile, Meredith Smith just chipping away at those wall balls. I heard Katrin Davis-Otter say that the most challenging aspect of this event for her was going from the rope climbs back to that second set of wall balls. She said it was a big challenge to overcome. The first set was okay. That second set, she said, felt like something completely different.
12 minutes, athletes. We're 12 minutes in. I mean, 60-minute time cap. 4 minutes remaining. Chelsea Lewis done with her rope climbs. She is on to her wall balls.
Now, Chelsea Lewis was actually the last athlete to her double unders, right? So she kept a steady pace, and it paid off for Chelsea Lewis. She made up that time on those rope climbs and is now sitting in the top three for this heat.
So we have our four athletes back on the wall balls. You have Meredith Smith, our leader, and I believe she just shifted, finishing her first 25. She can move to that wall ball target on the left. Chelsea Lewis, Barry Ferrari, Mindy Hughes, all onto their wall balls.
All I know is I need a pair of those pants that Chelsea Lewis has got on. Meredith Smith more than halfway on those wall ball shots.
3 minutes, athletes. fantastic job of heat number one. So we get some rep counts for you and some athletes on the double unders.
Let's see, Meredith Smith. 54 double unders. And Lewis at 59.
Good solid double under work by Chelsea Lewis there.
Hey, like I said, she was the most consistent of the bunch. She was very steady. Like I said, last of the double unders. But this was steady in the pacing and ended up making.
Heat number two coming out to the competition floor. Going to be our second look at this event for our women's individual division. Chelsea Lewis getting the upper 50s on her double unders on the second round of double unders on the way back from the lunges.
That'll be the 1 minute.
That'll be the score to beat. Folks, as you're making your way around, make sure you make your way to Vendor Village. Check out Reebok. Have some really awesome customizable regional gear, but you gotta get your name in there, gotta get it ordered. Get your name on the back of a regional jersey, along with your number.
30 seconds.
Make sure you head over to Rogue. Check those guys out for all your fitness needs, and 5'11 as well.
Rolling.
Boy, Wilson one lane away. And Welker Bolin round out your top three. George Janowski, one. Wilson, two. And Bolin, three. Dickerson and Stevens. Now along with the rest of the heat, all into the double letters. Again, this first 100 double letters. When they move into the wall balls, and again, just like before, folks, it'll be 50 wall balls, 25 on the target to the left as they are looking at the rig. And they'll transition to the target on the right for the second 25 before they begin their rope climbs. Total of 10 rope climbs. And they will come back to the wall balls and repeat the process in reverse. 50 on the total, 25 on the right, 25 on the left. Charjanowski done with their double unders. See her start to get this a 20-pound ball for our women. Wilson now moving forward to Jordan as his Bolin. Here we go, one, two, and three to the ropes. Just past 2 minutes. No female athletes completed this individual event yet. Chelsea Lewis, they have, I believe, 59 double unders. Into the second set of double letters.
So you said it, Larry, these ladies working on that first set of 50. It's broken up from target to target. 25 here on this first target, 25 on the second. Looks like Teresa there in lane number 5. Now moving on to the second target. As is Wilson here in lane number 4.
Charjanowski and Wilson right next to each other, both working on the last half of their 50 walls.
We are 3:30 in, all of our ladies chipping away at the 50 wall balls. Remember, 20 pounds is the weight here. And right after that, these athletes are going to make their way back to the ropes for 10 rope climbs. Trojanowski, our first athlete now chalking up, getting ready to take on all 10 reps. Chloe Wilson, and not far behind. As we have just passed the 4-minute mark.
Teresa with a good touch at the top. She'll move her marker up to rep number 2. One rep at the most. Chloe Wilson. Also scoring a rope climb. Morgan Bolin now done with her 50 wall balls. Her first 50, 10 rope climbs ahead of her.
One thing that's always cool when it comes to this style of events, Larry, is we get to see different variances as far as technique. Trojanowski using somewhat of a swing slash kip technique to get up the rope. Some of these other ladies alternating back and forth. Randy Stevens making way down there on your side, almost going legless form.
You said it. The ball, probably there. Maybe their next defense. Stevens with another good rope climb.
So athletes, we are approaching the 6-minute mark. Remember, 16-minute cap. So you guys have just under 10 minutes now remaining. Pro Janowski still our heat leader. She continues to chip away at those 10 rope climbs. Chloe Wilson, not far behind. Halfway done is Trojanowski, 5 reps in. Her marker sits on number 6. Chloe Wilson now adjusting her marker to the number 6 as well. That's a really cool added element this year with the rope rig. That little tuck in, they move up for each rep. Brandi Stevens doing an excellent job. Lane number 9 on her rope climbs. She's halfway done, 5. Marker on number 6. Chloe Wilson making another ascent. Looks like Chloe cut on a little bit of rest time. And she'll now advance her token to number 7. Putting her one ahead of Trojanowski. So we have a new leader in the rope climbs. It appears to be Chloe Wilson at 7:41.
Very narrow spots.
Trojanowski looking to finish out her first set of 25. Stevens already narrowing down to her final couple wall balls here. Chloe Wilson moving on to that second target for her second set of 25.
All the women at half minutes, both those athletes on target to Trojanowski now. Changing to the target on the left, and again she has cleared her first 25. A lot of leg action going in, a total of 100 wall balls, 10 rope climbs, plus the 100 foot overhead dumbbell lunge to start things off. Really going to impact the second 100 double unders you have to do before you start your last lunge. A whole lot of lower unit action going on. Keeping our eye on Stephen, hand in the air for Randy. Stephen's judge as well as Chloe Wilson's judge. Coming up on 12 minutes and 30 seconds, and it is going to be Chloe Wilson, the first to come back out and pick up her rope. And Randy Stephens will be right behind her. Chloe not wasting any time in lane number four. Rapidly approaching the 13-minute mark, and here comes Teresa Trojanowski. Here, 1, 2, and 3 going into the 100 double unders. It will be Wilson 1, Stevens 2, Trojanowski 3. We'll see how it comes out. Plus, we still have the lunge to finish up. 13 minutes in, 3 minutes remaining. No athlete finishing this event. In our first heat, 59 double unders, the top score. We should have several athletes surpassing that. Solid double under action going on. Wilson taking a big chunk out of it, taking a little bit of a breather. Stevens doing the same. Let's see which one of these athletes will be the first to pick up that dumbbell. Trojanowski also taking a little bit of a break. Bolin just a few reps away from joining them. Actually looks like Morgan Dunn, and she will step back out, picking up her rope as we approach the 14-minute mark. Chloe Wilson dumping the rope. She will be the first athlete onto the lunges. Chloe in lane number four, 2 minutes remaining. Chloe with the blue top and blue pants on, white shoes. She's easy to spot. She's the one lunging across the floor with that 55-pound dumbbell over her head. Randy Stevens is just a touch behind her, getting to the dumbbell, or fresh getting to the rope. Right now, though, Chloe Wilson with a sizable lead. Over what will be a race between Trojanowski and Stevens as they both pick up the weight at the same time. Wilson just moving right along, though, 14:45 on the clock. On her way to setting the fastest time in heat two. It'll be the fastest time going into heat number three as we approach 15 minutes on the clock. Chloe Wilson, less than 5 feet to go. One more lunge for Wilson. And Chloe will control it and step to the finish mat, finishing up ahead of the nearest competitors by a wide margin. Congratulations, Chloe. Her time could be right around 15:07. Out on the 30-second mark, Trojanowski just ahead of Stevens with 30 seconds to go. Belin done with her double unders, and she will join them on the lunges. 20 seconds. Trojanowski taking a bit of a pause to get readjusted. Will that give Stevens the opportunity with less than 15 seconds to go? Stevens picking up the pace. Trojanowski picking up the pace. San Antonio makes some noise. Let's cheer them across that finish line. 5 seconds to go. 3, 2, 1. Time. And we don't have our scoreboard up there, but it sure looked like Brandi Stevens finishing just under the wire in lane number 9, and Trojanowski just short of the finish line. Ladies and gentlemen, big round of applause for all your competitors in this heat, and hats off.
Nicole Wilson from CrossFit Tixie, setting the time to be number 3.
It's been a little rainy outside today, but that's okay. All the fun's inside the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas, for day 2 of the CrossFit South region as we continue with the individual female event number 3. I'm Jeff Breimer alongside Sheree Chan. And Sheree, day 1 was really fun. Day 2 already exciting, but now that we get into individuals for events 3 and then 4, things are going to be moving up and down the leaderboard.
There are still a lot of points up for grab. We have 400 points, so we're going to see a lot of movement going back and forth, and we're going to now introduce a workout that really looks to be quite difficult out there in the field, so it's going to be fun to see what goes down for the women.
So far, Camilla Black-Mazadeh is running the South Regional.
She has dominated Friday, and you know, that's no surprise. Camille has over 25 event wins at regionals, more than any other athlete by a long shot. So we'll see if she can keep that up. If she does have a challenge this weekend, it would be this coming event with the wall balls. So we'll see how she does there and if she can clinch a third win.
Closest athlete to Camille is Tenille Reed.
Tenille Reed, she's done phenomenal. She's had a second place and a third place thus far. No surprise, she got on the field at the CrossFit Games last year and took an 11th overall for a rookie season at the CrossFit Games. Not surprised that she just sort of cleaned up yesterday and is hanging really strong in that second place with 185 points.
An athlete that made a move yesterday, holding on to fifth, Candace Wagner.
Candace Wagner, I'm so impressed with her. More than anything else, I'm impressed that she took a 3-year break from the CrossFit Games. Her last appearance had been in 2012. She ended up coming back again last year, 2016, and it's clear that she is only getting fitter every year.
Quick look at the overall standings coming into this heat. Camilla Black-Mazadeh, of course, all 200 points still read, 15 points back, and Candace Wagner, a 2-point lead, holding on that valuable fifth spot. And here's a look at what they have ahead of them, Sheree, for 16-minute time cap.
100-foot dumbbell overhead lunge. That's going to be with the same dumbbell they've been using this weekend, that 55. 100 double unders, 50 wall balls. And then this is now where the event will start, really, is in these rope climbs. You'll start to see a differentiator. And, oh, man, once you get back to those 50 wall balls is when we'll really see who's separating themselves.
That's how they line up here for heat number 3.
Stand by.
Underway, heat 3 of event number 3 overall. Here from the Alamo Dome on day number 2. Right now in heat 3, these are the athletes that are kind of in the middle of the pack. And if they're going to make any kind of run to get a top 5, they've got to hit a couple of home runs today in events 3 and 4. 100-foot overhead walking lunge using, again, as Sheree said, that 55-pound dumbbell, and not just competition, Sheree, but as we get into the methodology of CrossFit and the reasoning we do certain events, this one-arm overhead lunge, really core to extremely. You've got to really stay tight in that midline.
Annalisa Marquez right here in your first lane. She's battling out with the opposite side of the field. Alyssa Christian for sort of the first place in this lunge. See who will separate themselves.
So we'll have about 4 athletes moving across is Annalisa Marquez out of Chandler, Arizona. Edged everyone out. Now we get into the 100 double unders. Quick trip there by Marquez, but she'll regather herself, and now she is moving. Anita Rabani, who had a nice little battle there with Camille for a while yesterday, then Camille just laid the hammer down, but she showed some signs of really being able to push the gas.
Anita Pravati got a sixth place in yesterday's second event. So I'm curious to see, was that first event of a 45th place just sort of a hiccup, and she's going to pull herself back from that? If that's the case, she's going to have to ignore the women around her in heat number three and imagine as though she is trying to beat the women who will be coming out in heat number five.
Looking along the field and the double unders, both athletes very steady. We have a couple of athletes trying to wrap up that one arm overhead walking lunge. In heat three of five, two heats have already been completed. And again, Marquez at the bottom of your screen in the blue pants with the purple knee sleeves had the early lead, and it looks like she may be done with the double unders, and she is. So it's going to be Marquez who will go on to 50 wall ball shots. And when you see Marquez coming to your picture right there, going to start off with 25 to the left side of that target, then move to the right side, and that will be the next 25. That'll give you a little bit of an indicator of where she is within 50 wall balls.
Annalisa Marquez here, she had a little bit of a hiccup there, got a no rep on the wall ball, but I'll tell you what, I'm not surprised that she's pushing it out here a little bit. She finished 13th in the regional last year, and she has been a CrossFit Games team member back in 2014.
Was on the team with East Valley CrossFit back in 2014. Next to her in the white top is Luisa Diaz, fifth in the Latin American region out of ELO CrossFit. And Marquez, again, out of East Valley CrossFit, though competing, as you said, here as an individual, but has been on the team 13th in the South a year ago. Former pro soccer player, played collegially at Arizona. Lane number eight, that's Luisa Diaz, again out of ELO CrossFit in the white top. Next to her in the black, Marina Ramos Jorge out of Latin America. Two-time regional team athlete, two-time individual team athlete. The last 2 years she was on the team here in the South region.
This is Luisa Diaz right here having a little bit of trouble with understanding what the standard is from her judge for the wall ball, so trying to make sure she knows what it is before she starts again and wastes a bunch of energy.
May have just been breaking below parallel at the bottom of the wall ball. That's usually what it is as long as you're hitting the target.
She does have a pretty wide squat there, so I could see how maybe that would get a little gray, but she's also quite short, so it could be the target up ahead. You can see she really has to give it a huge jump to be able to hit that target.
Wall balls obviously favor the very tall athletes. Not as long of a jump they can reach up there. Just a little short push usually gets it to the target, but the shorter athletes, whether it be male or female, as you mentioned, Sheree, usually have to do that little jump up. Right now, you're looking at Marquez, followed by Diaz, and in lane three, Renata Pimentel, the 12th seed out of Latin America, your top three on the wall balls. Marquez has moved over to the right side, shows she is in her final 25 reps of the first 50 wall balls. So is Marina Ramos Jorge on the left side of the gray pants and the black tank top. Yeah, still in her first set of 25 after picking up a few no reps. There's Anita Pravani in the red pants, black tank top, one to your left.
And she has her judge's hand up, which means that she's only got five left of those wall balls. So that's who we were really looking at. And she's pulling ahead first place in this heat so far. She has to ignore these women and pretend as if she's not in this heat and really try to beat that clock.
She really raced through the wall balls, but so did Alyssa Christian all the way over in lane number one. But Gravani will be the first to go up the rope in lane six out of Sao Paulo, Brazil, third in the Latin America region.
This is going to be a huge differentiator once they start the rope climbs. What we're looking for here is they don't waste a ton of energy on the first four or five. They waste a ton of energy here. By the time they get to eight, they will be smoked.
That is Marquez. And again, this is the rope that we saw a season ago at the games on the climbing snail, where if the bottom of the rope cut off, it's going to be obviously legless unless you can torque yourself up, but it's going to be legless until you can clamp down your legs. Alyssa Christian there with the red hair and the black tights, 29th overall at a Premier CrossFit in Tyler, Texas. Another thing about the rope that hangs off the floor, though, Sheree, usually when you have a long rope at your gym, 3 or 4 feet, hang on the floor, it steadies it just a little bit, a rope off the floor. Sometimes you can get to doing the helicopter a little bit.
And what we saw there with Alyssa Christensen is that she wasted a lot of energy, like you said, trying to get that wrap on her feet, and that can happen with a rope climb. Let's hope it only happens with one. If we start to see that on all the rope climbs, that's going to really push her back, because she's currently sitting in the second place right behind Anita.
Out of Premier CrossFit in entire Texas, the 18th seed out of the South Central, Alyssa Christian, 29, 5'4".
And you can see that that's just a lot of wasted energy. So if she can just take one or two grabs above where she wants to, get just a little bit higher for her feet, she'll have a little bit more success there and waste a little bit less energy.
Marquez again in the black top, blue tights, coming down the rope in the battle of Luisa Diaz right next to her in the white top. Those are the top two slugging it out right now with Anita Pravati. And it's Pravati in first place, Marquez in second, and Christian in third, but Diaz not far behind, back to lane one. And Alyssa Christian, here is Marquez again in lane number nine, currently in second place. They are on their sixth rope climbs, at least Marquez on her six rope climbs. And from time to time, you can see the rope rig. You'll see the athlete go over and move a little piece, as you'll see Marquez. That's the indicator of the rep, a little magnetized piece that will move up with 1 through 10 on the bar. Pravati in the red pants, back up the rope next to her in lane five. Carolyn Frampton in the blue top. Pravati quickly finds the rope with her feet. Nice descent there, gets back down. Both hands get under the black tape. She's able to race on down.
And it looks as though from that magnet that she's about one rope climb behind Annalisa Marquez right there. And here's your differentiator right here on these rope climbs, is how much struggle is it to get up. It's not quite a legless rope climb, but it is for about 3 or 4 poles to get your feet up onto it.
Pravati makes a run, quickly going up. She went most of the way up legless before she signed to find the rope with her legs.
She's making sure that she has enough rope under her, that she's not just seeking the rope with her feet.
Back to Marquez at lane number nine on the eighth rope climb here. In lane six, Pravati on her seventh. Now nine rope climbs for Marquez. And that is Diaz in the white over lane seven against Marina Ramos Jorge in the black top gray pants. Past the halfway point, 16-minute time cap, nearing 9 minutes here in event number three. This is heat number three from the Alamo Dome in San Antonio.
And from our perspective, Annalisa Marquez has about one more rope climb before she turns around and really goes back to, I believe, the most devastating part of this workout, which is another 50 wall balls.
Chloe Wilson did it in 1508.34 here in the South. So that's the time to beat if you want to be first place overall, with a couple of heats remaining in event number three. And the final rope climb is about to come up for Becky Freeman in the gray top and the black tights out of Albuquerque, New Mexico, from CrossFit Albuquerque. Pravati on her ninth. Checks the judge. Got to touch the blue, not the black anchor that holds the rope up there. So did the smart thing. Check with the judge. Make sure she had the rep.
And at this point, we are really close to seeing somebody finish here.
So here comes Becky Freeman in lane number two. So quietly, Becky Freeman has taken over the lead here in event three and heat three.
Way to go, Becky. Becky, in this year's Open Masters competition, she ended up taking 47th in the 35 to 39 online qualifier position.
There is Marquez again in lane number nine. Again, you just saw Chloe Wilson at 1508.34. Double checking the judge, and Pravati is now off the rope. She'll start her first 25 in her set of 50 wall balls. So the order, top 1, 2, 3 right now. You've got Freeman in first, followed by Marquez, and then Anita Pravati. Pravati was on the screen in the red pants. At the bottom in the blue is Marquez. Let's take a look at Katrin David's daughters, 1148.71 set in the East, and that's a minute away from where we are right now.
She was already off the wall balls at 9. 9:21. So that was almost 2 minutes ago.
What?
5 minutes to go, athletes. 5 minutes remain.
Fourth place is Renata Pimentel. So Pimentel still in the hunt.
Luisa Diaz here in eighth lane out of LO CrossFit. She's from Brazil.
She'll begin her wall balls. Again, Marquez in the blue tight, still on her first 25 with a set of 50. Again, they'll be on the targets if you're watching on the left from this vantage point. When they move over to the right like Marquez just did, they have 25 remaining.
What a relief when you move over and start that next set. Now, you're going to be unbelievably taxed to be able to pick up that jump rope and have any coordination, and that's kind of the beauty of having the jump rope right after the wall balls here. So we'll see who'll be able to keep their composure.
Getting down to Becky Freeman. We've seen a couple, as we look at Becky Freeman, we've seen a couple athletes where it's been an event three for the men and the first two heats for the females. The 50 wall balls, that second set, I've seen a couple of athletes go down to a knee before they started the jump rope. If you're trying to outpace yourself, you can get crushed in those second set of 50 wall balls.
Yeah, and depending on, you know, you knowing yourself in the wall balls, it might be smarter to do a set of 15 than a set of 10. Set of 15 and then a set of 10. Not for the sake that you can't do the 25, but for the sake of being able to pick up that rope and go and not spend a whole minute or two resting.
Well, depending on how fast Maggie Freeman can get these double unders, she's going to have a pretty good chance of getting past Chloe Wilson's 15:08.34. As long as she keeps a few big sets of the double unders and control the dumbbells, she should be fine.
She looks poised and very much in control, so I think she's going to be able to get through those just fine. You saw she did one mess up, didn't even hesitate, just put the rope on the other side and started going again.
Very calm, cool, and collected, as you just mentioned, Sheree.
From CrossFit Albuquerque, out of Albuquerque, New Mexico.
Stops, checks with the judge just to make sure what rep she's on, how many more she has to go. Took a deep breath and gets back at it. Marquez should be getting close to the end, and she is. The judge's hand is now in the air. She's completed her set of 50 wall balls, so she'll go back and get set for her second set of 100 double arms. Back to Becky Freeman. As soon as the judge's hand goes up, there will be five reps remaining in the double unders. So Renata Pimentel on the blue top now joins Freeman in the double unders, but Freeman with a significant lead, and this is where you really rack up the reps. And now you're starting to see some trips on those double unders from Becky Freeman.
Renata Pimentel out of Brazil. She has a martial arts background. She's also a state public defender. It's amazing the backgrounds these ladies have out here.
Freeman will bounce up, so get ready. She has 100 feet to go in 1:08 if she wants the event lead. Just a, looks like a slight bend of the elbow. She can keep it locked out. She should stay steady.
She looks strong right now. I think she can make it all the way without putting that dumbbell down.
She just
proved me wrong there.
And again, in the alley breathing, doesn't matter. You can do both sets with one arm. You can switch off. However, just has remained overhead. Here is Annalisa Marquez out of Chandler, Arizona.
And she ended up doing all of her double unders there unbroken. And she looks pretty calm and cool going through this as well.
Marquez in the foreground. Up top in the background, that is Freeman, who she's trying to catch. Now Marquez puts down the dumbbell. Again, 15:08 is the top time. And I believe Chloe Wilson is going to hang on to the event lead through three heats.
This is the point in the event that you need to just hang on, and it hurts. The stabilization is hard, but you have to just look forward and not think about the pain.
If she can get in under 15:59, that was Randy Stevens' time. Wilson and Stevens, the only two females to finish so far. So any athlete that gets in under the cap is going to be in the top four or five. So if Freeman and Marquez can just beat the cap in 35 seconds, they'll have a top four finish so far. But Marquez is really laboring. Freeman's got a good chance. Freeman at the top of your screen.
Marquez has to look at that clock and not think about pacing it and really just cruise her way down. She has the strength and the legs to do that.
It's going to be Freeman that's got to make a big move. She has 10 seconds.
You've got to get on the red mat, not the green. Once you get to the green, you've got to run to the red. She's going to be close, but she's going to be just a couple of reps short because getting on the finish mat counts as a rep, too. But a great effort there by Becky Freeman and Annalisa Marquez. They both capped out, but Freeman was right there. And that should be good enough for third place overall. So Freeman and Marquez, a nice little battle. We also saw Ravani in there in the red pants. As you see her on the screen, nice little battle there. We're going to get set up for heat number four coming up. So three heats down, two more to go. For all the official information, go to games.crossfit.com. Stay right here. We're going to be right back with heat number four. Inside the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas, getting ready for heat number four, but vet number three, individual women in the CrossFit South Regional in day number two. I'm Jeff Brightwell alongside Cherie Chan. And in heat number four, Cherie, these athletes trying to make a move today.
We've got two athletes that are only 6 points out of a top 10. So right here, these athletes are trying to get into that top 10 so that they can be in the final heat tomorrow and set themselves up well. Here's what we're looking at. What a fun little ditty. Each year we see an event where not all the athletes will meet the time cap. This one is 16, and it's proving to be that event. You look right in the middle at those 10 rope climbs. That's really what is separating these athletes, and then being able to hit those 50 wall balls just continues to sort of separate them even further.
Here's how they will line up, and in lane number 8, Brenna Castro's got to do some work to get back up into that final heat. Started out in the final heat yesterday, but it's fallen down to heat number 4.
Brenda Castro, she came into this regional being the first seed out of Latin America, so high expectations after the phenomenal performance that she had at 17.4 from Nuevo Leon, Mexico. So we're keeping our fingers crossed that her second event was just a fluke.
Beth Spearman, Kelsey Kill, two athletes to watch here. They're in lanes 5 and 6 as well. Spearman in lane 6 and Kill in lane number 5. And that's how they line up as they get ready. And they'll start it off with 100 feet of overhead dumbbell walking lunges.
Stand by.
And they're underway, 100 feet. Dumbbell overhead walkie lunge, gotta stay tight in the midline.
You have to really stay calm here, try to move fast, but stay calm because this definitely doesn't determine the winner. And who we're looking at right now is Beth Spearman and Kelsey Keneal. And the reason we're taking a look at them, other than being phenomenal, is that they're only 6 points away from that top 10, and they share points. So they're currently tied in that 11th place. And the only reason why Kelsey is in the 11th is because she had one higher finish of 7th than an 8th for Beth yesterday. yesterday. So we'll see if they can kind of break through out of this heat and into that final heat.
Spearman in the red pants. It was Keel in the purple pants. Off to the right, you see him in the middle of your screen. That is Spearman again in the red pants. Just above her in the purple, taking about a 5 foot lead is Kelsey Keel. Brenda Castro about to get ahead of the red line and get on to her double unders. And Castro's going to have a big day here, get back into the hunt for tomorrow to have a chance to make a run.
And she looks nice and calm right there. She's in the middle there in the white T-shirt. You can kind of see how well the double unders are going to go for the athletes by how much errant movement is going on, whether or not they sort of look like a nice, smooth spring, not a lot of labor. And that's really what we're seeing there with Brenda.
And last year, 42nd in the regional, but came in with a lot of hype, went head-to-head with Brooke Wells this year in 17.4. Now hopeful to finish in the top five, but again, still has 400 points hanging out there. Four events remaining and a chance to make up some ground, but cannot have another costly event. Again, we've only got six events this year, not seven, so it's 100 points. They're not available to try to make up any kind of ground. Coming up to 2 minutes into the event, again, a 16-minute time cap before they move forward onto the wall balls. Looks like Armstrong's the first to get onto the wall balls.
Yeah, Armstrong there.
At a CrossFit Abilene in Abilene, Texas. Strelth out of the South Central, 23-year-old regional veteran.
And that was sort of followed very quickly by Brenda Castro and Raven Barnett.
Spearman back there in the red pants. Yet the finish. There is Armstrong again, 14th, coming into day number two of the regionals. Okay, now here we go. It's 50 wall balls. There'll be two separate targets. The way you look at it from here, they're on the target to the right. Once they've done 25, they will move to your left, their right. That'll be the second 25.
And let's not forget about the weight of this wall ball. We're looking now at a 20-pound wall ball, so a little bit heavier. And, you know, it really does, as it comes down, just feel like a brick house landing on your shoulders. And these ladies are not making it look like that at all. They're making it look so smooth as they catch it. And we just saw Kelsey Keneal get a no rep there for depth. So you do need to hit the full bottom of the squat, meaning the hip below the knee at the bottom.
And most of the time, if you see an athlete look over to the judge due to a no rep, it's not because they did not hit the target. The athlete knows if they hit the target or not. They're worried about the depth.
That last shot that we saw there with Ariel Armstrong, I was kind of wanting to show a little bit of a difference in some of the wall ball strategy. If you look at Brenda in the white shirt, she relaxes her arms into her chest as she goes down, whereas Ariel has her arms out. Now, I want you to think about the fact that they're about to go do rope climbs. So whatever you're putting tension on or a lot of that energy into, that's going to be much harder for Ariel to walk over and be successful at those rope climbs versus Brenda next to her, who's kind of getting more of a relaxed arm in the bottom.
Always good to get those hands up under and use that vaulting motion instead of trying to clamp down on the side as Castro on that last set of 25 in a lane number seven. Ariel Armstrong, less than five reps remaining. Now it looks like Brista Mayfield just ahead of her in lane number four.
Very similar approaches.
As Mayfield went right to the rope, but here in lane number seven, it's Ariel Armstrong. So her and Mayfield one and two. Armstrong will steady that rope. Again, these ropes are the short ropes we saw in the games a year ago.
Brista Mayfield, the other female that is out there right now.
There's Mayfield in the black top and the purple tights. 13th, just on the outside of getting into that final heat out of CrossFit TBR and at Texas. Five times to the regional. She's been around. She's been relatively close. 11th to 12th, a seventh place finish in the Old South Central back in 2012. A gymnastics background. She was on the Texas Longhorn team from 06 to 2009.
Right there in all black, we just saw Stina Pinilla. She was a little bit behind off of the double unders there, but she really caught up after those wall balls and got onto that rope really quickly.
So Mayfield making her way up. You can kind of see in the background those magnetic numerical markers on the left side of your screen. They'll move that magnet up. You a big fan of the old school Price is Right, and I guess they still have it now, but I'll go back to Bob Barker. It's like Plinko.
There you go. And we're looking at Brista Mayfield here. She's had some great finishes this week in a 15th and a 13th, and I bet it would just really make her weekend to get a top 10 finish in this event.
Good view of Mayfield, or rather Keel and Spearman there. Again, Spearman in the red.
Ariel Armstrong is still hanging out in first place, however. She's on her sixth rope climb, so she's right in the thick of it. Here's Brenda Castro.
Getting set for her fourth.
And you can see that they have to do a little bit of a legless rope climb before they can get their feet onto the rope.
Castro wanting to do well today to jump back up into the final heat, stay within striking distance of a top five qualifying spot. Can get that seventh in Latin America in 2014. That's when Latin America used to take just the top qualifier to the games. Now the combined regions, the last couple of seasons, the top five in each regional qualify for the games.
Just as a little bit of a reference for time, Katrin David's daughter out in the east set an event record of 11:48, and her split off of the rope climbs was just now 7:09, so it just passed.
Pretty incredible time by the two-time fittest woman on earth.
Silent battle right now between Ariel Armstrong and Brista Mayfield. They have both on their eighth rope climb.
Leaders right now, Armstrong, Mayfield, and Kelsey Keel. Let's head down to Nick Zielinski.
Yeah, guys, you guys have already talked about Kelsey Keel quite a bit. She went to the games last year as team, but she made that switch to individual this year. She told me she's not really watching the leaderboard. She's got other people doing that for her, but of course they're giving her updates. She's just trying to enjoy the process, have some fun, and she's doing a great job sitting in 11th place so far. She finished event two with the 7th place finish, and she's looking forward to the back end of this workout. Those last 50 wall balls, the 20-pound wall ball, she said she's got strong legs, and that's a movement she really likes. So maybe look for Kelsey Keel to kind of maintain through these rope climbs, get back to those wall balls, and that's where she can make her push, those wall balls and then those overhead lunges to finish the thing off.
Thanks, Nick. Keel in the red pants. I believe I identified her mistakenly as Spearman earlier, but in the red pants is Keel. That Team Parallax a year ago in 2016, 19th at the CrossFit Games.
You'll see over in the middle of your screen, Ariel Armstrong, who is hanging out in first place, has now been failing a few rope climbs. So with only really two left, what we're going to see here is potentially one of the other females really catch a lead at this point. And this is that moment that that's happening.
So again, that's Keel in the red pants, and it's Spearman who is next to her in the white tank top and the black pants. And again, it is going to be Ariel Armstrong holding on to first place right now. She is in her final rope climb. So Keel in the red pants, Spearman in the white top, black pants.
Brista Mayfield is also on her last rope climb. So Armstrong is working on rep number 9. And I believe she's actually now out onto the wall ball. So she is the first person out to those wall balls.
Moves a chip, and it looks like Castro is about to get onto her 10th. Rope climb as Keel moves the marker up as well. There goes Brista Mayfield in lane number 4 at a CrossFit TBR. So it looks like this should be, if I'm looking at that marker onto the side correctly, going to be her 10th rope climb for Brenda Castro. Going to find out soon enough. And it looks like it is as she's going to head back and get into the wall balls on lane number 8 for Brenda Castro.
Now we start to see that we've got two of the females here, and now we've got about three or four ladies on their final rope climb, but way to go, Brenda Castro, just fighting through those rope climbs.
There is Brista Mayfield. Again, the first 25 now on the right side, and she is already moving to the left target, so she has 25 remaining in the set of 50.
Ooh, and on the left there, we just saw Stina Pinilla, she's on her final rope climb as well. And man, the heart getting onto that, it looks like a struggle on the legless, but man, she's got so much fight that she hasn't missed one of them.
So Mayfield, your leader, and the second set of 25 should be under 20 at this point.
This second round of wall balls was a much bigger challenge than the first round. So let's get behind these ladies and cheer them.
And one more heat remaining here at event number three. For the individuals, it is day number two here at the CrossFit South. Chloe Wilson still with the time to beat at 15:08.
This is really where the athletes are starting to feel some pain when you go into this event. It's so hard when you look at it on the screen and you read the movements and you see them going, and they make it look so easy. But when they're done with those rope climbs and they have to pick up this 20-pound ball again and throw it 50 times at a target, this is really where you have to dig deep and just allow the pain to happen.
For any of these individuals that are able to finish this event, it's going to put them in a very, very good spot. Only two athletes have finished the event. As we mentioned, Chloe Wilson at 15:08. Randy Stevens did it just under the cap. In fact, less than half a second, 15:59.65. So if you get through this, you're going to have one of the top times with just one heat remaining. As you see Chloe Wilson's time, she did it back in heat number two.
And we now see Brenda Castro just flipped on over to her second side of wall balls. Brista Mayfield was already there on her second set of 25.
All of these athletes, especially Brenda Castro, has got to really sell out today to get back in position. Again, don't have to win the region, just need a top five, and right now she's an entire heat away.
She's a heat away, but not very many points away, really, if you look at it. I believe if I do the math correctly, she's only 10 points out of a 10th place spot. And there she is.
Krista Mayfield about to get onto her double unders. Mayfield can be steady, and she's doing a nice job. I know a lot of people watching at home saying she's taking too long, but when you're in your double unders in a fatigue state, it's good to take a couple of extra seconds like she did. Take the deep breath, get composed, get into the rhythm.
Yeah, you could grab it real quick and start going and fail a bunch of reps and then miss a bunch of time, or you could just take a few seconds to compose yourself and then look as smooth as Brista does on the field right now.
She's got 3 minutes to go with the time cap. Very smooth. She stops, checks over for the count for her judge, and Kelsey Kill in the red pants now moving on to the double unders. So it's Mayfield and Kelsey Kill, the only two athletes, and now they'll be joined by a third athlete. Lane number seven, that's going to be Ariel Armstrong.
And Kelsey Kiel said she was good at those wall balls. She said she has strong legs, and she just proved it right there because she didn't get off the rope in that second place position. So she cruised through those wall balls.
Mayfield again, the leader. It's going to be Kiel and Armstrong trying to track her down. Out in lane one, Sheena Hammer joins the club. Lane two, Kendall Watt, and then Sheena Hammer in lane one. But that's Mayfield. She's done. Now just has 100 feet to walk with a 55-pound dumbbell over her head back to the other end of the Alamo Dome.
She has plenty of time to finish this event in the time cap right now.
Again, finishing into the time cap would give her a top three. If she beats 15:08, it'll give her the top spot. And again, Randy Stevens, the only other athlete to finish this event today, 15:59.65.
We now have seven women onto the double unders, which is more than we've seen thus far at this time frame.
Well, you like what you see out of Brista Mayfield, not trying to rush it, being very steady with each step.
But actually moving very fast compared to some of them. She's really smooth as she goes through with a little bit of speed.
She's got halfway to go, and she's got 30 seconds to do it. Now, she doesn't have to get on the green. That's when you carry the dumbbell onto the red mat. So she's got to get to the red mat. She is a little past halfway before she finally drops the dumbbell.
And it'll be Kelsey Kiel right here in the red pants who gets on second.
Minute to go in the time cap, and here comes Kelsey Kiel. Mayfield now just picking the dumbbell back up. She's got 50 seconds to finish this thing off. She's got about 40 feet to go.
All of these ladies that are on the field with the dumbbell right now have a chance to finish it in under that time cap if they go, if they just pick it up and look forward and go.
Just over 15 feet remaining for Mayfield. That's Ariel Armstrong. Mayfield Looks like she is going to be able to finish this, and she'll have a second place overall. The whole foot has to be on the green, and she will run across, and she's going to be in. She is second place overall, 15:44 unofficially for Brista Mayfield out of CrossFit TBR.
If I'm a betting girl, I'd say that's a really good chance to get her in the top 10 right there going into the next event.
A few more athletes, in fact, four more athletes on the walking and lunges that will cap out. So, Brista Mayfield, only the third female to complete event number three, and Kelsey Kill caps out, but wasn't far behind her. But there's a very happy Brista Mayfield. 6 in the South Central coming into the regionals.
Slow and steady, Brista Mayfield. Like, when you're looking out there, she just looked calm the entire time, no matter what was happening on the floor, and that's what won the race for her, being able to keep that composure throughout the whole thing. Way to go, Brista. Can't wait to see as we refresh the leaderboard and see if you pulled yourself into a top 10 spot after this beautiful win in event number 4.
Very calm and collected. Let's head to Nick.
Here with a winded Brista Mayfield. Brista, congratulations on finishing the event. You're the third woman to finish the event. How would you describe the kind of pain that you're going through all those movements?
It hurts, but you just gotta make yourself go. Pick things up when it, kind of according to plan, but then you just gotta adapt to it if it falls apart, so.
Sitting right outside the top 10 heading into this event. You got one more event today. What's the game plan for event 4? What are you gonna do going forward to make that move to get closer to that top 5 position?
Go all out. My coach and I like to say that it's time to go ham and time to attack it. So that's the plan for the rest of the weekend.
All right, Brista Mayfield going ham. Looking for her in event 4. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Nick. So Brista Mayfield will be in second in event number 3 right now. Only 3 athletes have finished inside the time cap as we will get set up now for the final heat here in event number 3 for the individual females. And will Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet be able to get a third first-place finish? We're in San Antonio, Texas, inside the Alamo Dome for the final heat of event number 3. I'm Jeff Breivin alongside Sheree Chan. We'll be joined a little bit later by Nick Zielinski. And here comes the top 10 after day number 1. Again, Camille, an impressive first day, trying to lay the hammer down here on day number 2 in a race. All doubt. I don't think there's any doubt, but if there is, just erase it.
I have no doubt at all in Camille, and all my love goes out to her, but my eyes are going to be on Tennille Reed for this particular event. I want to see if she can get an event win and really make a statement of her own.
We've seen it already 4 times today, but here's another look at it. In a 16-minute time cap, you've got to go from one end of the floor, do some work, and back to the other end of the floor.
And really what we're going to see is that 10 rope climbs is going to be the differentiator. And then when we go down onto those 50 wall balls, it's going to be, hey, how much energy do you have left and how much heart and go do you have left? Or as Brista just said from the last heat, can you go ham at this point?
Let's take a look at the lane assignments. Here's Camille in lane number 5, and as you just mentioned, next to her in lane number 6, Tennille Reed. Your overall
Camille
leader,
Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet, right here.
2014 Games champ, trying to defend that regional title. Well, we've mentioned it, just got her degree. It just seems like a totally different Camille. There's a lot of stress trying to get that degree, and she didn't mess around with like an easy degree either. A lot of hard work went into it, but just looks like her mind is really free this weekend.
Stand by.
I think to your point there, that really has just a lot to do with experience. We talk about it in different heats, different athletes, really a lot on the teams, but it's the experience. This is going to be, if she makes it to the games, which we are kind of making that assumption, we don't want to jinx her, that'll be her 8th trip. And so there's a ton of experience, and with each year comes a little bit more calm and a little bit more understanding how to control the things outside of your realm of control. Like right now, she's getting a lot of no reps on those lunges, but she's not even hiccuping. She's just doing what she's supposed to do, going back and making it done. Because as you can see, she's in the back of the line right there.
Well, your athlete to watch, Tennille Reed, is out by about a 4 or 5 foot lead. And she will come in, and she is second place overall, trailing Kavila Black-Mazadeh. She goes immediately, doesn't waste any time, grabbing the jump rope.
And one of the things when you're trying to analyze events and see how people will do, is you try to see what their backgrounds and whether they lend themselves well to it or not. Well, Tennille Reed has a background in basketball. Now, I know that doesn't seem like it would make sense for this event, but she has a great background in CrossFit methodology. So now add in the ability to make some hops when we're talking about the wall ball, the rope jumping, and the double unders. And I think this is a really good event for Tennille Reed.
Your leaders early, and it is still very early in this heat. Going to be Candace Wagner and Bethany Branham. Time to beat from heat number two is still there at 15:08.34. Brista Mayfield made a run at it. Wilson still hanging on to it. Again, just three athletes have got in under the time cap. And there he goes, Branham. Branham's going to be the first to get on the wall balls. Reed right behind her.
That was almost a rep for rep right there. And they're almost rep for rep on the wall ball right now. The cool part about that is they can fuel the energy off of each other. They can see somebody else is there. And it makes you move just a little bit faster.
Now, away from just the competition, taking a look here, this is my favorite part of regional competition. The games are no doubt a blast. It is the ultimate experience. You're in a big stadium, but here at the regionals, you're right up on the fence line. And someone else who's down there right now, Nick Zielinski.
Thanks, Jeff. One of those names we were told to watch coming to this weekend is the lady on your screen right now, Bethany Branham. She absolutely crushed the Open. There's high expectations coming into this regional for her, and she's absolutely living up to those. She's sitting in sixth right now, 2 points out of that fifth qualifying spot. I've talked to a lot of athletes today about this event, men and women, and all of them have been pretty much a consensus. They said this event is absolutely brutal. I asked Branham about this event. She said, this one's fun. She loves the idea of different movements. She likes heavy wall balls. She likes the shortened rope climbs, and she likes overhead lunges. She may be a rookie, but she's definitely not performing like it. Look for her to make a move here in event three. She's been exciting to watch so far as she tries to catch that fifth spot.
Thank you very much, Nick. And again, Bethany Branham out of CrossFit Hutto in Hutto, Texas. Boy, what a vast background. 8 years of gymnastics, 3 years bodybuilding, 4 triathlons, multiple half marathons, and personal training. A wide and vast background. That's what you need here in CrossFit.
In that gray tank right there, that's Rachel Campbell. She actually tied our ladies coming off of the double unders, so she was in that third place getting to the wall balls.
Tennille Reed in the black top and the yellow shorts. She is going to be to the rope first. 10 rope climbs. You look right behind Tennille Reed, you'll see that little chip they will move up, indicating which rep they are on. So it's on one, she's on her first rope climb.
And you know, that looked really smooth. You kind of look at the athletes on that first rope climb, you see what their technique was, you see how much energy it's taking them to get their feet wrapped around it. She did not take much of a rest at all to get to that second one. You know, that tells me she went into this saying, I want to go to the games, I'm going to make this my event.
Bethany Branham now joins Tennille Reed on the rope climb. So again, Reed just overtakes Branham just by a fraction. Is that Branham right there in the black top and the black shorts?
Just past 4:30 on the clock.
Got a 16-minute time cap, a little bit past 4.5 minutes. And there's Margo Alvarez wanting to make a little bit of a move today. She's in good position out of the Vineyard CrossFit and leads a Utah, a four-time Games vet. Her highest finish back in 2015, where she finished ninth, a 22nd place a year ago at the Games.
And this is a great event here for Margo to go ahead and make a move when you look at her past strengths and weaknesses. The wall balls and the rope climb should be really good for her to be able to pull ahead here.
So your top three here in the final heat, Tennille Reed still in first. Second is Bethany Branham, and in third place, the Games veteran, Margo Alvarez.
And Tennille Reed is just looking so strong and fast through her rope climb still, even though she's on the fifth one.
Random on her fourth and Alvarez on her second. And now we will see Tennille Reed get set to go into her sixth. So she's past the halfway point. There goes Alvarez. And that should be her fourth. She now moves up to her fifth rope climb.
Yeah, and I want to say Tennille's marker was moved up to that seven.
Tennille Reed a little bit closer than we thought. Yep. Goes up to her eighth, so this will be her eighth. She has three more to go. Is Alvarez making her way up?
Oh, a beautiful coming down off of the rope there for Alvarez. You know, James mentioned it in the team, but coming down can be just as important as going up. You can create so much stress in your upper body by hanging on too tightly as you descend, and that was just a beautiful descent by Margo.
Alvarez may have overtaken Branham by about a half a rope climb. It's Alvarez, she's done this plenty of time in the games and the regionals, has a very good cadence, just gets off, moves a chip, turns around, and she is back up. And now Branham slowing down a little bit on the rope climbs.
Tennille Reed, however, is not slowing down. And if we look at the event record right now, when we look at Katrin, David's daughter, she came off the rope climbs at 7:09. So Tennille is very close to that time.
This is her last rope climb. And again, looking at that 7:09 marker, just now hitting 7 minutes, hits the blue.
And she does it.
She's ahead of pace by about 5 seconds. But we'll need to get on that wall ball. She goes immediately to it.
And we're looking for these wall balls to be really just around the 3-minute mark to finish. And if she can do that, she will be hunting down the event record by Katrin David's daughter.
Get about a 5-second lead if you're looking at the pace on Katrin David's daughter, who finished at 11:48.71 and again was off the rope about 5 seconds faster than Katrin. Still a lot of reps to go in this, but right now, past the halfway point, 5 seconds ahead.
Tennille Reed, she's Midwestern University physical therapy right now. She has been a great regional competitor, always hitting into the top 10. And the 2016 was really her breakaway year, getting to the games and finishing in 11th. It's very rare you see a rookie go to the games and finish that high.
Final rope climb for Margo Alvarez. She will get on the wall ball, so she has moved up into second place. Next time marker we'll be looking at for Tennille Reed, by the way, 9:21 when she got off of the wall ball. So that's a little bit over a minute away.
Man, way to go for Margo Alvarez. It's got to feel really good to look down the field and see that there was only one other female on the wall balls, because she knows that she needs to do that. She's 10 points away from fifth place, and fifth place is one of those places that gets you to the games.
Alvarez on the left and the gray top, Reed on the right, and the black top and the yellow shorts. It's 1 and 2. Reed on the right side is in first, with Alvarez in second. In lane number 5, we take a look at Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet in first place overall, and she is onto the wall ball, so currently in third in this heat.
A solid position being in third place right here. She got a no rep on the wall balls. She's gotten quite a few no reps in this event with the lunges and now the wall balls, and man, she's just hanging tight, listening, and trucking through.
Reed drops the wall ball, and 9:21 is the next time marker. She wants to stay on pace. Candace Wagner shaking the arms out. She again has that final spot to the games right now in fifth place, and is still in the rope box.
We do have a hand up for the judge of Tennille Reed right now, meaning she only has 5 wall balls left, so she likely will not break Katrin David's daughter's record, but likely will be the winner of this heat at this point.
Candace Wagner, you see her on the screen, the Black Tigers, Black Tigers hunched over the wall ball. Finish up those rope climbs. So Wagner trying to keep pace, doing a nice job. She gets a top 5 or 6 in this event. She should be just fine to hang on to that top 5, if not just barely out. Tennille Reed on the double unders, and there is Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet on her first set of 25 with the wall balls.
And you can see that Camille's one of the shorter athletes. She puts her hand on one of her arms under the ball in order to make that height where the other one stays out on the side.
quick no rep for Depp, but is back in Depp plenty of time now.
And Margo Alvarez now has gone out onto the floor to join Tennille Reed.
Getting a nice high jump on those double unders. That looked like an intentional break there. Didn't clip the feet or anything. So Tennille Reed keeping pace. But let's see if Alvarez, who looks very smooth up top with a great top, see if she can track down Tennille Reed. Then her Tennille Reed broke, but Alvarez is in a double under zone. Finally, she breaks.
This second set of 100 double unders is so much more difficult than the first set of 100 double unders because you're under a little bit of metabolic distress.
200 total double unders under stress on the way to the rig, on the way away from the rig. Less than five to go. Tennille Reed has finished her double unders and now on to the one-arm overhead dumbbell lunge.
Time to beat today and in the South is 15:08. So Tennille, as it's looking right now, is going to blow that away.
3.5 minutes to beat that time at 50. She's going to crush it. Here's Margo Alvarez, and Margo Alvarez is going to be about 40 feet behind once she picks up the dumbbell. If Reed keeps her pace, Alvarez won't catch her, but if Reed breaks and there's no sign of, you know, collapsing, even though she broke, Reed should take it. We'll see if Alvarez can track her down a little bit.
This whole point, like, the numbers thing fascinates me. So I look at this and I think, oh my goodness, Tennille Reed's only 15 points away from Camille. What does that mean? That means if you've got more than three people right now, which there isn't, if you had more than three people, that would mean Tennille would take over that first place because Camille just got to her rope. And that is a very important move for her to be able to hang on to that first and not see it go away.
Well, Alvarez is not going to catch Reed. She has less than 10 feet remaining. Again, has to get to the red mat. When you get to the green, you can grab the dumbbell and then make your way onto the finish mat. And she is going to crush the time to beat unofficially 12:42. That eclipses Chloe Wilson's 15:08. Great job by Tennille Reed.
What's important to Margo right now is she's sitting right now in seventh place with 135 points. She wants to get into that fifth place. She needs to be at least two spots ahead of Candace Wagner. That's really what she needs to be doing.
And right now, she's got three people between herself and Candace Wagner who just started the double unders.
That is very tight.
Alvarez, about 20 feet left. Just needs to be steady. 15 feet away until she gets to the green again. She's got to get on the red and get that chip timer across the green pad is just where you can reach up, grab the dumbbell, and then run across to get your final time. But has to get on the red to complete the event. She's going to have second place overall in the event as the feeder fully across the green. She's in under 14 minutes, so she is second overall in event number three. And here comes Camille LeBlanc-Mazinet down the middle of the floor.
And I know we've said that, you know, Camille's done so amazing so far with two wins, but this is a reason why she does amazing in the regionals and wins, because she's not winning this event right now, but she's staying focused and staying ahead of the women that she needs to so that Tennille doesn't grab too many points and get too close to her.
Bethany Branham starting to make up some ground in lane number eight. Branham with a very quick pace.
If Bethany Branham gets it in underneath the time to beat, 15:08, there's a good chance she could take over that fifth spot.
You don't see a lot of people with a calm look on their face in this movement, but Bethany Branham had it as Camille's got to go back.
And there's now a lot of women kind of encroaching up onto the field with the dumbbell. We've got four women that race out there right now.
That's the first time Branham has just hesitated slightly. She took just a slight pause, moved on, and now it's wiggling around. She'll have to break. Camille may pass her. They are even now. Oh, we're going to go step for step. This will be fun. Branham on the bottom half. Camille in the middle of the screen. And they are step for step. Branham about a one-step lead. Branham one more step to get on the finish mat. And Branham just ahead of Camille, who dropped the dumbbell. She's going to have to come back. So Branham logs right around 15 and a half. Then it should be good for fourth overall. Here comes Camille. That should be good for fifth overall in event number three. What a race for third in this heat between Camille LeBlanc-Mazinet and Bethany Branham. Up there in lane number three, Candace Wagner, who needed to make up some ground, kind of got caught in the middle of the pack. But if she can hang on here, and there goes the dumbbell, and we run into the 16-minute time cap. So it looks like on the top of my head, five, six females finished event three here in the South. Not a lot completed event number three.
And that right there, as you saw on the floor by Alexis Johnson, is what it feels like to finish that workout.
So Candace Wagner made up some ground once she got off the rope climbs, but it was Tennille Reed that put on the show.
And Tennille Reed, so impressive on the speed of which she went to the rope climbs. It was obviously strategic and planned. That was less than 10 seconds. And she moved from that rope to that wall ball to the double under without thinking, just going and staying calm. And, you know, looking at her out on the field in this event, I saw a woman who's like, I am coming to play this game. I am going to the games.
Tennille Reed, incredible performance. She's with Nick.
We'll grab it. Oh, we're back. We're live. This is live TV. It's been the Camille and Tennille show here in the South region. Tennille, you take first place here in event three. You're sitting in second place coming into this event. Was this an event you kind of earmarked, knowing you can make a move on Camille for that first place spot?
Well, I didn't really think about it like that, but I knew that wall balls and rope climbs are usually my thing. Like last year, those were the two workouts that I got first and third in. So I knew those combined, like, it was really gonna help me make a good push, but I never underestimate Camille or any of these other competitors because you never know what they've been doing in training compared to you. So honestly, I just decided I'm just gonna do this at the pace that I know I can do it, not pay attention to anyone else until this last little run, because that's where it's either you either want it or you don't want it. Like, I really wanted it.
You could tell you really wanted it. Tennille, you kind of crashed the games party last year, an outstanding finish at the games. How did last year's finish kind of change or mold your training coming into this year?
Oh, I can't even express to you like what training for the games has done for me as an athlete. Like, having to go through all those months of training for that has made me so much better. I mean, it's almost like you kind of have to get over that hump. Once you make it to the games and you put in all that extra work and all that training, it makes stuff like regionals not look as hard.
Well, you're certainly making it look very easy right now. Tennille, congratulations, event three victory.
Thank you.
Tennille Reed, again, 11th of the games a year ago, and she didn't rest on that, making a statement here on day number two from the Alamo Dome. For all the official information, go to games.crossfit.com. We'll be back a little bit later, but now let's head out to the studios at CrossFit HQ.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back inside the CrossFit Update Studios. I'm Sean Woodland with Annie Sakamoto and Pat Sherwood. Sam Farber, Caleb Banfield, and Brooke Enns will be joining us here in a little bit. Want to welcome everybody from the East and the South in. Just saw a pretty solid event in both venues. Great finish in the East between Catherine Davis' daughter, Carol Ann Reason Tebow. Then meanwhile in the South, Tennille Reed racks up her first event win, and Margot Alvarez continues her charge up the leaderboard.
Yeah, I think Margot knew that she had to put together a good day today. She's starting off really well, second place on that first event today. And that'll definitely move her, I think, inside the bubble of fifth place.
And Tennille, so impressive. I mean, again, getting her event win, this is somebody who barely missed qualifying in 2014 and 15. Last year, took fourth place there at the South Regional, went on to the Games, and her rookie debut finished 11th, and now she's kind of showing us why.
We're waiting on updated results and standings from the South, but Tennille Reed really doing herself a big favor and might tie Camille LeBlanc-Bazinet for the top spot on the overall leaderboard.
You kind of crashed the Games party last year, an outstanding finish at the Games. How did last year's finish kind of change or mold your training coming into this year?
Oh, I can't even express to you like what training for the Games has done for me as an athlete. Like, having to go through all those months of training for that has made me so much better. I mean, it's almost like you kind of have to get over that hump. Once you make it to the Games and you put in all that extra work and all that training, it makes stuff like regionals not look as hard.
Well, you're certainly making it look very easy right now. Tennille, congratulations, Event 3 victory.
Thank you.
Everybody can train hard, but she makes a really good point. I mean, there is no substitute for experience and what that can do for you at all levels.
You can't buy experience. She's got it now, and it just gives you that confidence. You know, what I'm doing actually works. I've been here before, and like she said, I've been to a larger stage than this, so I know that I can perform, and yep, she's executing.
All right, social media is very busy today and will be throughout the weekend. Let's send it over to our social media decks, where both Kayla Banfield and Brooke Entz are standing by.
Sean, social media, as you can imagine, and all of you watching can imagine, it doesn't stop. It doesn't slow down. It's constantly moving, and we're doing our best to keep an eye on it. That's why we got two of us from now on. But some of our favorites, starting the kids really young watching regionals and the Games, and I'm sure that's going to continue on as they're growing up.
She looks very engaged there, which is good to see.
Very engaged. I always love watching all the community pictures, seeing the sea of yellow right now, tons and tons of people coming out, supporting their team, supporting their individuals. I'm actually just a little bit jealous of that and what that would feel like to look out into the audience and see all of your people cheering you on.
I also always love the supersized faces as well as masks. They always look funnier supersized.
I've had my face supersized one time and it was not the best picture, but the fact that it was supersized was fantastic.
Absolutely.
And, you know, maybe not a ton of fitness in this picture, but puppies.
Absolutely. We couldn't help but feature this. We really needed to feature a dog, and it's a super cute photo.
I did. You know, I checked in with Riggs before we picked this one. He totally approved. He also thought that puppy was cute. Okay, this is a really, you can maybe explain this. I'm pretty sure you know this person.
Yes, this is one of our, let's call him a larrikin from Australia, and he always posts funny photos. He obviously was trying to get some tips from the people walking on the air runners at regionals, and he's using his arms, which I'm sure does help to some extent, but he's probably taking that a little too far.
Honestly, I like the technique. I do like the technique. Weddings and East Regionals. This is someone who is at a wedding and also trying to pay attention to their East Regional and what's going on too. Being in two places at once.
At least they're hiding it behind the napkin, so not being too obvious about it.
Yeah, cover it up just a little bit. Can you imagine what that'd be like though if something big happened and you got really excited at the wrong time of the wedding?
Jump up on the desk.
And absolutely love this. This is a volunteer at the East Regional. Dave Castro actually gave her his hat, and she just is explaining how lucky she is and how happy. You know, that was really, really wonderful for her. She traveled a far distance to volunteer, and it's nice to, you know, see Dave, other people paying attention to them.
And she gets to walk away with a little memento.
Yeah, exactly. I wish I had a hat. We have a question. You had a question for the desk.
I do. So the question that I wanted to know is, if you guys were a piece of CrossFit equipment, what would you be?
I'd probably be the pig. I think that suits me, just some big lumbering piece of equipment.
Well played. I would probably be a very minimally used piece of gear, and that's running shoes. I think one of the few CrossFitters that actually likes to run and run long at that.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to embrace what I hate most. I'd be a wall ball.
Wow.
Whoa, good for you.
Yeah. Nice, okay. All right.
And the next time I'm wall balling, I'm just going to say to myself, Be the wall ball.
Well, in the South, the men will be facing event four. That's coming up next. We're busting out the heavy kettlebells for the first time in regionals. We're doing some handstand walking and some toes to bar. Here's what's on tap.
The 2017 Reebok CrossFit Games Regional Individual Event 4 is four rounds for time of handstand walking, toes to bar, and kettlebell deadlifts. Each round begins with a 60-foot handstand walk, followed by toes to bar, and then deadlifts. In round one, 10 reps each of toes to bar and deadlifts are performed, followed by 12 reps in round two, 14 reps in round three, and 16 reps in round four. Men use two 150-pound kettlebells, and women use two 106-pound kettlebells. The time cap is 11 minutes.
We've seen this play out in the East as the South gets ready to take on this event, and even with the women, but the kettlebells here are really the sticking point.
I think the grip is really what it's going to come down to, managing your grip. The handstand walk isn't effortless, but it's going to become negligible when you compare it to the grip work that you have to do on the toe bar and the heavy kettlebell.
Yeah, of the three elements, nothing is creating the struggle like those awkward, unwieldy kettlebells, yeah. Without a doubt.
Who do you like for the men in this event in the South?
You know, I haven't picked a number one pick in a while, so I'm going with one right now, and that's Logan Collins. Yeah. I think this is going to play very well for him. He is obviously crushing it with a third, and a third. 172 pounds, handstand walk on the toes to bar should be very nice for him, but those big bells, I mean, even though he's one of the smaller guys, he's got a 525-pound deadlift, so I think this triplet lines up very well for him.
And I'm going to look for Sean Sweeney here. As our own analyst Tommy Marquez has stated, he has hands that are like oven mitts. And in a grip-heavy workout, I think that's really going to come into play. He has a rodeo background. But what I also liked is he had an Instagram post after yesterday and his little mishap with the dips. And it was a very positive post. He talked about that his effort on event two put him in a pretty deep hole to crawl out of. But he is confident that he can still get out of it, and I think that kind of confidence and that positive attitude is going to help him.
Yeah, still a very close race on the men's side of things in the South. If you are watching the South stream, we're going to get you back out to action here in just a second as the men are up next in San Antonio, Texas for event number four.
Josh, thanks for taking out the time. Real quick, your thoughts on the test so far that you've seen being competed in the East and the South regions?
So I've done the first four workouts. I have not got to watch any today. I'm actually in the middle of coaching my son's baseball game, so haven't got to watch for a few hours. I got to watch the first event. I watched the East finish the first event at three, and I love the test. I think the first workout was phenomenal. I think it's a great test. It's faster than I thought it would be. You know, the run, can't really slack off on the run, but and you got to push through the rounds. So I love that test. I think it's great. Step two is fast and hard. You know. So dumbbell snatches, 80 pounds, you gotta be able to move that weight really quick and then be able to do dips. And then event three is really gross. I think that workout is a lot harder than it looks on paper. You look at it on paper and you're like, this isn't bad at all. And then you get into those 50 wall balls and 10 rope climbs and then go back to that wall ball and it feels like it weighs 50 pounds and not 30 pounds. So, yeah. And then event four is, it's just a gripper, you know, it's kind of like who can hold on to those dumbbells on the toe bar, the longest kind of thing, so.
Well, a lot to look forward to, for sure. We're certainly looking forward to seeing you in action next week here in the California region. And speaking of California, the game's making a huge move going to Madison, Wisconsin. You have the privilege of competing, relatively speaking, in front of home fans. For the biggest event in CrossFit on your previous four trips to the Games, how does it going to Madison change maybe the way you look at the California regional and that one opportunity this year to compete in front of family and friends?
Yeah, it's cool.
I'm excited for Wisconsin. I think it'll be great. You know, obviously I got to go for the regional first to get there, but and it is, it's going to be different not to be able to drive from my house up to LA, you know, for the games. And so, yeah, it makes the regional that much more fun that, you know, you do have your families and friends and all your close relatives there, you know, in that home setting. So it'll be fun. I'm going to go out there and do my all and do my best for all those workouts. And I'm really looking forward to it. I'm excited to get back in the competition for sure.
And you were able to win the regional last year. Looking at the test, the competition that's out there, what do you think your chances are of repeating?
You never know. You never know. You know, I don't go out and make any predictions, but I like the workout. I feel good, and so, you know, I'm going to go out there and make it tough, you know, for anybody to try to challenge me, for sure. So, but, you know, I don't think it's going to be easy by any means. It's going to be hard. It's going to be a hard thing to do to repeat winning that region.
Before we let you go, you were one of the originators of the term that's been put on CrossFit bumper stickers and CrossFit t-shirts. Dave Castro is a prick. Now, a week ago, Dave put out